When the first forward pass was thrown back in 1913, no one could have imagined the impact it would have. Quarterback would become the game's most dominant and glamorous position. Quarterbacks like John Elway, in 4 years at Stanford, he finished sixth on the all-time list. Quarterbacks like Brian McClure, this Bowling Green standout, threw for over 10,000 yards, second to only one man, Boston College's Doug Flutie. No quarterback ever electrified stadiums like the Magic Flutie. Before he was finished, he owned the NCAA's all-time record. In 1986, Kevin Sweeney has taken dead aim at college football's most jeweled crown. Under the watchful and patient eye of his father and head coach Jim, Kevin has matured into the total quarterback. With the record comes the glory. But for Sweeney, it's the tradition of college football's best quarterbacks.
The thing that will mean most to me is that it's bound in college tradition, like the people you just named. You named the Fluties, the Elways, and all those people who have made great names for themselves, not only in college football, but also in the NFL, and it's bound in a lot of tradition, and it's an honor just to be a part of it.
From Las Vegas, Nevada, ESPN's Thursday Night College Football presents a PCAA matchup between the Bulldogs of Fresno State and the Rebels of UNLV. It's very windy here in the desert. Travelers advisories posted for blowing dust. But down on the field here in the Silver Bowl, it does not appear that those northwest winds gusting to 20 miles an hour will be much of a factor. We'll find out as the game goes along. Welcome to Las Vegas. I'm John Sanders with Gene Washington. Fresno State and UNLV, that is developing into quite a rivalry. And in addition to the rivalry between two teams that really don't like each other, toss in the fact that for some seniors on UNLV's team, this is their last chance to play before the home fans here in the Silver Bowl. That should add to the emotion of the evening.
Well, John, to add to that, I think this team would like to show that they're much better than their 4-4 record indicates. You know, there was a stretch where they had three ball games that they lost by a total of 10 points. So they would like to show not only their home fans, but the entire country that they are a good football team. And the best way to do that is to beat a good team in Fresno.
And if you were with us last week, for many of you, a first chance to see Kevin Sweeney, who still needs 464 yards in his final three games to break the all-time passing record of Doug Flutie. But if you were with us last Thursday, you know there's more to this offense than just Kevin Sweeney. However, it does start with the quarterback. It starts with number nine.
It certainly does, John. And Kevin Sweeney is the glamour boy of the offense. He has in his wide receivers Gene Taylor and Stephen Baker to go along with him. Terrific wide receivers. But the thing you have to look at is not only is this a passing team, but they can also run the football. James Williams, their running back, last week had a terrific performance against Fullerton. He has four games where he's over 100 yards. So not only does his team pass the ball very well with Sweeney, but they can also run the football when they need to.
Well, in order for that offense to move, they have to have the football. That means they count on the defense to get it to them. Fresno State is very proud of its defense, but last week against Cal State Fullerton, the Dogs let down a little bit.
Well, they did let down, but I think the reason they let down last week against Fullerton is because, quite frankly, they overlooked Fullerton. They thought they would beat them easily, and that wasn't the case. But they won't let down this week. They're not going to overlook this Rebel football team. They're the second best team in the league, giving up only 82 yards per game rushing, and they're led by a terrific defensive end, Jethro Franklin, who has 17 and a half sacks. They'll be ready tonight.
Talk about defenses. Let's talk about the Rebel defense, and if you were to put numbers on it, it would look like a 2-4-5 defense. It's almost like they've turned it upside down.
They are using a defense really to suit their personnel. The fact is that at this team, they do not have defensive linemen. They only have about three that can really play. Best athletes on this football team are the defensive backs. They use five defensive backs in every situation. Most teams will only do that in obvious passing situations. Five defensive backs, four linebackers, and two down linemen. But their defensive backs are some of the best defensive backs in the country. Alvin Horn leads that group. He has four interceptions, and at free safety is his second leading tackle on the team with 77. This is a terrific group of athletes.
If you don't believe that, you can ask Kevin Sweeney. We'll show you the numbers that he has put on the board in his first three games against this outstanding secondary.
The important thing is the percentage completion. Look, 42%, that's about 10 points below what Kevin Horton really throws at. Now look at the ratio between interceptions to touchdowns. Three interceptions for every touchdown that he's thrown against this team. The reason is because this team plays a lot like the Raiders. They challenge you to throw the football against them, and they have the type of people that can really make that challenge work, but they also risk giving up the big play. So don't be surprised if you see the football in the air an awful lot tonight.
We mentioned it's a big night for 17 seniors, their final home game, but let's talk specifically about one senior. He'll start at tailback tonight. even though a week ago in his senior season, that's when he made his very first collegiate start.
Rod Emery, a great story. Prior to last week's start, he only had 48 yards rushing the entire season. He goes for 123 last week. Tremendous story. Because of that, he gets another start tonight for the fifth-year senior.
And behind him is Kirk Jones, another senior. There are 15 others. They would like to go out in style. It is the Rebels of UNLV against the Bulldogs of Fresno State coming up on ESPN. ESPN's live presentation of Thursday Night College Football is being brought to you by the U.S. Armed Forces. It's a great place to start. By McDonald's, it's a good time for the great taste of McDonald's. And by Michelob, exceptionally smooth, distinctive taste is why the night belongs to Michelob. When you think of Las Vegas, you think of the strip, of the glitter, the glamour, the stars that are Las Vegas. So did Coach Wayne Nunley. He came up with Rebel Starburst 86. Yeah, he asked the stars to help his football program.
Honesty is the best policy. And listen, once in a while, take that. Boy, have you got it made, baby.
Well, I am a Nevada resident, and also I think the Rebels are doing a very good job. And the coach is terrific. Wayne Nunley is a really very strong guy. He do miracles.
And the first miracle he did was get interim taken away from head coach in front of his name. Yes, he has a contract, a new three-year contract as the head coach here of the Rebels of UNLV. On the other side of the field, Jim Sweeney in his ninth season. Sweeney, what an outstanding job he has done. He still has hopes that his team could wind up in a bowl game. We are set for the opening kickoff tonight. Back to handle that is Jim Cook, number 17 for UNLV. They have two kickers, Cook and Libinati. And back deep to receive, we will have Kelly Skipper and Brock Smith. We're set for football here at the Silver Bowl in Las Vegas, Nevada. I'm John Sanders with Gene Washington. Delighted you could be with us tonight. A very important game, especially for Fresno State in their hopes to go to a bowl game. The low kick, Smith falls down. Mally picks it up at the 4-yard line. Across the 15, he's cut down as he gets near the 18-yard line. So for the first time tonight, Kevin Sweeney will be on the field with his offensive unit. Outstanding numbers for him. He needs those yards, of course, to catch Doug Flutie. And working with him, Williams, Mosley are the running backs. Outstanding wide receivers. We've talked about them a little. Baker, Taylor. Keep your eye on the tight end, Flug. And the men up front who do the job, higher in the middle, Chalantzeff, Kazarian, Savage, and Withicombe. That's the offensive line. At the 29, it is first and 10. First possession of the night. Midfield position. A little bit of a delay to the fullback, Mosley. He powers his way for about five. And let's set that defense for you. The down linemen in the middle. Wiley and Knight are the two down linemen. Outside, Barone, Harris, Johnson, Cooks. And look in that backfield. Glasgow, the senior, getting the start tonight. Blue, Horn, Hollis, and Nelson. Those are the five secondary people. They will be all over the field. 7-yard pickup. The ball at the 26-yard line. Williams for the first time tonight. He's got the first down as he slices his way near the 35-yard line. James Williams out of his tailback spot. Anthony Blue made the tackle. Number one. And the You can see what James has done in his 19 games. We saw this last week. We saw the Bulldogs go to the rush. We expected them to put the ball in the air a little bit more tonight. They have their first down of the night. At the 35-yard line, we're just underway. At the Silver Bowl, still 14:30 to play in the first quarter. Ball at the 35. Sweeney will put it up for the first time tonight. Right down the middle. Baker's got it across midfield at the 48. Did he catch it? The referees say he did. Baker's first catch of the night.
Well, John, this is the thing that Kevin Sweeney is known for, being able to throw the ball downfield with a very strong arm. He finds time in the middle. Stephen Baker makes a nice cut on the artificial surface. No one in there to stop this pass, and he comes up with a big reception. And I think the nice thing about this Fresno team, we've heard so much about how Sweeney throws the football, but it's those running plays that keep those linebackers up close to the line of scrimmage that allow for those passes to get open in that midfield area.
17 yards on that pass play, ball at the 48 in Rebel territory for the first time tonight. Doc Wise has come in the middle of that defensive unit. Sweeney with a fake, he goes deep. He's got Taylor out there, can he get to it? No. Overthrown. Gene Taylor was deep. He had some company in the backfield with him. Hollis was right down there. A long pass, and we've seen this before too. Sweeney had the injury problems, but he wants to show him that he can go deep.
Well, they'll always throw three or four passes deep early on you just to let you know to be aware of it. And what happens is that opens up those sideline passes, the comebacks to the outside. And that's probably Sweeney's best pass is that sideline pass and a comeback to the speedy receivers about 15 yards downfield.
Ron Jennings comes into the lineup now. Williams at the line of scrimmage, maybe a couple, and he is necktie tackled out of bounds as he got to the 46-yard line. That was Hollis who ran him out. That's Alvin Horn. We will keep an eye on Alvin. Second on the team in tackles, even though he plays that free safety spot. He has four interceptions to lead his team. The other thing about Alvin Horn, he is from Fresno. This, Gene, is what he lives for, a chance to take on the Bulldogs.
There's several players on this Las Vegas team from the Fresno area and playing against fellas they know very well. So to add to the fact that there are a lot of seniors playing in the last game, what guys playing against each other who grew up together.
In and out of the hands of Jenkins. He was in first down territory, could not hang on.
Number 82, Ron Jenkins. Not one of the starters at 5'10", 181, the junior. Sweeney throwing to the outside. The wind could become a factor here tonight. I don't think it's a problem right now. This ball was a little high. Jenkins should have come down with a catch, but it could become a factor a little later on as the wind swirls around in this stadium that's three quarters enclosed.
The fair catch called for back inside the 5-yard line. So at that point, the Rebels will have it for the first time, and Stallworth will come out. Steve Stallworth, they call him Strip number 10. He's the starting quarterback. With him, a senior and a freshman in the backfield. We've already touched on Rod Emery, who will start tonight at tailback. But a freshman has taken over the fullback spot. Outstanding receivers, Gladney, Thomas, and keep your eye on Cedric Davis. He's a tight end, and he's a good one. Here are the men up front, Mike Contreras, along with Sweeney and Oprah in the guards. Al Dominique and Rick Girard are the tackles, and Girard just might be the best lineman on that offensive unit. The holding call will push it back inside the 5-yard line. They'll go half the distance. So from about the 2.5, we'll catch the call from our referee tonight.
Holding.
Ghetto.
During the kick, post-scrimmage kicks foul. First down.
First down. Backed up near their goal line. First time the Rebels have had the football tonight. Take the ball to the fullback. Deflected the pass intended for Emery out of the backfield. Jethro Franklin, number 67. One of the down linemen, along with Ramsey and Walker, got a hand on it. Let's set that defense for you. Jethro Franklin, we've talked about. He's a good one, number 67. Walker Franklin also working up front with him. Behind him, the linebacking core. Keep your eye on Grayson and Hanneman. They'll be all over the field. Greer and Nunn also starting. Williamson, Wilburn, Webster, and Stewart. Wilburn expected to be constant company tonight for Thomas. Thomas out of the lineup right now. George Williams is in. It is second down and 10. Ball just outside the two. We're just in the first quarter. Loose football. Diving back to get it is Stedman. About the 1-yard line, the Rebels maintain control of the ball. Oh. So backed up to the 1-yard line now. Here it is from behind.
From the end zone, you get a look at the Fresno defense. Bad handoff on this play. There wasn't much there anyway. As we mentioned before, this Fresno defense, second best defense in the league. They lead the league against the rush. They're going to be very tough for the Rebels to get anything going, especially in this situation.
Third down and long yardage. The Rebels backed up near their goal line. Straight ahead running. Brightman breaks free at the 5 to the 10. He's got a first down to the 15-yard line. Michael Stewart made the tackle, but a quick pop that time from the fullback, the freshman, Darren Brightman. He picks up good yardage.
This is a big play, and you have to give credit to the offensive line. They do a good job of blocking. Number 32, Brightman, the freshman, he sees the hole, and he breaks an arm tackle. That's what makes this first down possible. The strong running by Darren doesn't go down with the arm tackle, picks up a first down, and now the Rebels have some room to operate with.
They do indeed at the 15-yard line, first and 10. First down of the ball game for the Rebels from the University of Nevada, Las Vegas. This is a PCAA matchup. Stedman's first pass of the night. He goes deep, tearing down the sidelines and overthrowing Gladney. Tony Gladney, a senior from Foster City, California, was out there, and Stedman overthrew him. It'll be second and 10.
Check out 89, Tony Gladney.
The Rebels of UNLV coming in with a record in the PCAA of 1-3. They're 4-4 overall, but Jeannie Bardi touched on it. Those losses have been by very close margins, all of them.
Three games in a row. They lost those three games by a total of 10 points. So, as we pointed out before, they're much better than the 4-4 record indicates.
Emery and Brightman are the running backs in the I formation. This is Emery on a sweep right at the 15, cuts it up across the 20 near the 22-yard line. Pretty good yardage, about 7 on the play for the tailback, Rod Emery. Keep in mind, he did not make a start until 1 week ago. He has just hung in, playing behind Kirk Jones, who was expected to set the all-time rushing record for this team and maybe the conference this year, but here's Emery starting.
8 yards on the play for the Rebels.
What a week he had last week.
123 yards rushing in his first start. Fifth-year senior, that's quite a performance. You can see he's not a very big kid. There's Kurt Jones, number 20 on the sidelines, who was probably the most highly recruited kid around in the California area during his senior year, and from my high school, where I went to high school in Long Beach at Poly High School.
On third down, Stedman looks over the middle, now brings it down, brings it back. It's intercepted, picked off by Wilburn. Wilburn right there to make the interception. He almost fumbled but manages to maintain control. And the Bulldogs of Fresno State have come up with the first turnover of the night. There he is, number 8, the junior from Carson, California. Wilburn picks off the pass, and the Bulldogs are in business.
Fred Wilburn is considered to be the best defensive back on this Fresno team, a terrific athlete, number 8. He's not very big, 175 pounds, 5'10", but he's in the right spot at the right time on this play, and quite frankly, Stallworth just throws the ball. He forces the ball in there, and Fresno comes up with it on about their 31-yard line.
Mosley, the fullback inside the 20. He's got room down the sideline, cuts it back into the end zone, touchdown. The Bulldogs of Fresno State break on top. A 31-yard touchdown run by Anthony Mosley. So Mosley scores his fourth touchdown of the season, and the Dogs are howling early here in Las Vegas.
John, I think there's quite a difference in terms of the intensity of the Fresno Bulldogs this week against UNLV than there was last week against Fullerton. Last week, I think they were a little sluggish in the beginning of the football game, maybe taking Fullerton for granted. Certainly not doing that this week as Mosley goes in for 6 points and they get off to an early lead.
A 31-yard touchdown run for the sophomore from Selma. Barry Belli set to tack on another point. He is now tied the PCAA all-time scoring record, 7-0. The Dogs lead.
Fresno State 7, UNLV nothing.
Quarterback Steve Stallworth wanted to throw this ball out in the left flat, as you will see when he takes a snap and comes back and looks that way. But what happened was that his receiver was not open. Now he starts to scramble around, thinks his receiver is open, but there is Fred Wilburn. He steps in front with a big interception. That's something that Coach Wayne Nuntley certainly didn't want to happen. He wanted the momentum to be going his way, and at this point in the ball game, it's certainly going the way of the Fresno Bulldogs.
Barry Belli kicks it off. The deep man are Thomas, who fields it right at the goal line. Back comes George Thomas, number 3, out to about the 13, maybe the 14-yard line. And once again, Gene, not good field position for the Rebels in their second possession of the night. First drive ended in the interception and the quick 31-yard touchdown. So back once again comes Strip Stedman. Eddie Bustamante made the tackle defensively, and we'll see how the Rebels can handle their second possession. First time they started at their 2-yard line, so I guess you'd have to say this is much improved field position. They're at the 14. Stallworth on that first possession was 0 for 3, and he threw the interception.
John, their coach Wayne Nully said before the game that he felt that they needed to run the football effectively to keep this good Fresno defense off balance. Don't want them to settle in.
Emery and Brightman are the running backs. This is Emery. Cutting outside, he'll be dropped for no gain. Moving up quickly is Jethro Franklin. Jethro was not happy last week, and he is set out to make amends tonight.
Well, in the ball game last week against Fullerton, he got trapped an awful lot, really didn't make very many tackles.
He was very, as you say, unsatisfied with his performance, and he told the coach he was going to make up for it when he got another chance on national television. He has it tonight, and I think that you will see the true Jethro Franklin, who has 17 and a half sacks, by the way.
Thomas and Darnell Woods right now are the receivers. Woods is 81. Looking to Thomas' side of the field, now under pressure, almost goes down, still gets away from the tackle. Cuts it back at the 20-yard line. Near the 25, he's close to a first down. Stedman kept his feet, kept his head, and dodged a couple of bullets that time.
Well, Steve Stallworth certainly isn't known for his agility as a quarterback. As a matter of fact, they're afraid when people put pressure on him that he won't be able to get away from the rush, but he certainly does it on this play, does a nifty bit of running, gets outside and back and across the middle and picks up a first down out to about the 25-yard line.
So Stallworth on the pickup, 12 yards on the play and a first down at the 25. Stripped Stallworth running the offense. Tight end shifting over is Cedric Davis. He's an excellent tight end, a freshman and a good one. Out of the tailback comes Emory Walker, is right there to make the tackle across the 25 near the 27, giving two on the play. Mike Walker, number 90, moving over to play the middle tonight, 6'3", 250-pound senior from Richmond, Oklahoma. Emory now has carried three times. He has 8 yards, got two on that play. It is second down and 8. Great drop this time by Stallworth, throwing to the side, pass is complete to Thomas, slips under the tackle of Wilburn, very close to another Rebel first down at the 35-yard line. We'll watch the spot. Looks like it's enough.
George Thomas gets the ball out in the flat. Look how you can't even see the defensive back hardly in the screen. The reason they give him so much room is that this kid has flat out great speed. He averages 22.1 yards per catch. They have to be afraid of him. If they have single coverage, they're going to back off. They will not come up and challenge him.
Byron Nichols now in that defensive secondary, replacing Williamson for the Bulldogs. First and 10 at the 35. It's the fullback. Breaks a tackle at the 40 to the 45. Close to another first down. A quick pop that time by Darren Brightman, the fullback. It was Wilburn who made the tackle, but Brightman got another quick 10, maybe 11 yards.
And number 5, Michael Stewart.
Maybe the Rebels saw something in the films last week with Fullerton against Fresno, because Fullerton ran the ball very well, about 150 yards against the Bulldogs, and they gave up an average of only 82. So they may have seen something in the blocking schemes, and they've run the ball fairly well so far here in the first quarter.
Brightman, 25 yards on 2 carries. It's first and 10 at the 46-yard line. 8:38 to play first quarter. The Rebels are down by a touchdown. They try to go deep. Tipped away at the last minute. Going up to tip it away is Byron Nichols, number 3. The intended receiver was Darnell Woods, number 81. He was open for a moment, but Nichols recovered nicely.
He makes a good play on this because he avoids the interference play. Watch, he reaches over, knocks the ball away, and yet doesn't touch the offensive receiver. Kind of puts a hand on the shoulder, but the official didn't see it. That's a terrific play, because from that spot on the field, usually we would have to go through the receiver to knock the ball away and risk pass interference, but he got away with it.
Second down and 10, still at the 46-yard line. A little bit of a delay this time. Emory out of the backfield for about 5 yards.
That's a good call, and I think that we'll see that draw play a lot more as this ball game goes along, particularly when you have defensive ends like Jethro Franklin, who are big sack people. So you get in situations where they think you might be throwing the ball, and you come with that draw play, and it can be very effective.
8:05 remaining first quarter. It's a third down and 5 call now for the Rebels. A long 5. They're just across midfield. Straight back, throws short. Emory, first down out of the backfield, falls across the 45 to the 43-yard line. The tailback slipping out of the backfield. They decide to go to the short route. They're doing an excellent job at this point in the game, Gene, of mixing things up against this Bulldog defense. There is Wayne Nunley.
I don't think you can really make a living throwing the ball deep against Fresno, because their defensive perimeter is so good. And if you're going to be successful throwing the ball, I think you have to throw it underneath the coverage and try to work on the linebackers. And the Rebels have been doing that effectively.
A first down. Ball at the 43-yard line in Bulldog territory. The Rebels on a move. This drive started at their own 14. Power running by Emory. He'll pick up about 3 to the 40. It'll be second down and 7. Walker, number 90, made the tackle. And you can see quarterback Steve Stallworth, now a senior. He had some big shoes to fill when he came here, of course, because he had to pick up the quarterbacking duties for Randall Cunningham. Ball at the 40, second down, 7. Clock continues to move, 6:53. The blitz is on. Stallworth spins away. Now he's in trouble at midfield, and he's dropped. He was able to spin away one time, could not do it twice. And banged down by Anthony Nunn, number 96.
The Bulldogs put the blitz on. You can see the linebackers sneaking up there. They do a pretty good job of protection initially, but no one is open. Anthony Nunn, number 76, 96, comes up with a big play. He gets the sack. But the quarterback, Stallworth, he had time to get the ball thrown, but actually there was no one open. You have to give credit to Fresno's defensive backs.
And for Nunn, his 5th sack of the season. It's third down and 17 now for Strip Stallworth. Again, he's under pressure, and he's dropped just by the ankle, all the way back at his own 42-yard line. That's Jethro Franklin. That's sack number 18 and a half now.
Jethro does a good job. He's lined up just off the center's nose on this play. Pretty good job of blocking, but he continues to work. He stays with it, grabs a hold of Stallworth. Stallworth decides the better of it. I think he could have thrown a football, but I think he decided not to force it, take the sack and just punt the ball away and not give Fresno that good field position.
Stephen Baker set to receive the punt of Bob Hulbert. Hulbert gets it away. He's a left-footed kicker at about the 30-yard line. Baker lets it bounce. Now he's got to move away from it. UNLV got the roll, the ball inside the 15-yard line. That's where the Bulldogs will have it when we come back to Las Vegas, Nevada. On Saturday, Bill Arnsparger certainly will be there for LSU as the Tigers take on the Tide of Alabama, 7:30 Eastern time. Ray Perkins will be there as well, along with all the Alabama fans, live right here at 7:30 on ESPN as we continue our live coverage of CFA football on Saturday night. Yep. The Tide and the Tigers should be a dandy. Join us. It all begins with the college scoreboard show at 7 o'clock Eastern time on Saturday night. 7-0 Fresno State scoring after an interception on a 31-yard touchdown ramble by Anthony Mosley. Third time the Dogs have had the football. They do not have good field position. Backed up at their own 13-yard line. First down and 10. Straight back is Sweeney. Deep down the middle looking for Baker. Can he run under it? Yes, Stephen Baker inside the 25-yard line. He put it up and Baker ran under it.
There is no way Stephen Baker is supposed to come up with this catch. Number 25, David Hollis, is way, way back in the coverage. There's no way that Baker is supposed to get it, but he actually outruns the coverage. And in order to be able to do that, Kevin Sweeney had to throw the football a long way. There you see him striding. The ball is a little short, but he's thrown this football about 55 or 60 yards, and Baker just outruns the coverage and comes up with a tremendous effort. And that's why he's averaging about 25 yards per catch.
He got a 64 on that one at the 23-yard on a 64-yard pickup. Sweeney, 2 of 4 for 81 yards. Big numbers thus far. Comes right back the other way. That'll be interference as they tried to pick up Gene Taylor, number 1, on the far side of the field. But Teddy Nelson, the young man from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, was right on top of him, and the flag went down at about the 13-yard line.
Well, the official's going to make the call. Just before we take a look at here it comes, let's see if the defensive back grabs Gene Taylor before the football gets there. There he grabs him. But if they use the same rules they use in the NFL, which says that it's only interference if you can catch the football, if you have the ability to catch the football, I don't think he could have caught that football on that particular play.
I think you're right. I don't think it was a catchable pass, but here's the call.
Defensive pass interference, automatic first down.
The football will be placed at the 12-yard line and knocking at the door again. The interference call went against Teddy Nelson, a senior. At the 12, the backs will be split, Williams and Mosley. And they moved. Obviously, they were in motion that time. You see, Anthony Blue was coming on that play, but the flags and the whistles had already been thrown, so we'll back it up 5 yards. Still in the first quarter, 4:52 to play.
John, I think it's interesting to note that over the past several weeks, the offensive performance, you see Jim Sweeney on the sideline, head coach from Fresno, offensive performance, passing performance by Fresno had tailed off because of Sweeney's injuries. But as the weeks have gone by,
head ball, illegal procedure, offense, first down.
He's gotten better, and I think tonight we've seen evidence of the fact that he is back. He's close to being 100%. When he can throw passes like he threw on that long one to Baker, he certainly has come back, and now he's putting fear in the hearts of those defensive backs.
It'll be first down and 15. Also shows you that here at the Silver Bowl, the wind, which is very strong from the northwest, not really affecting you. Almost intercepted. That one was right in the hands, and it could have been a long, long run for David Hollis, number 25, intended for Gene Taylor, but Hollis was in position for the interception.
Hollis has three interceptions on the year, and as you said, John, he is in good position. Nearly comes up with the interception here. He steps in front. This is a long pass out to the sideline. If he catches this ball, there's nothing between him and that goal line except a lot of green astroturf.
Well, why is it their defensive backs rather than wide receivers? They don't catch as well, right? Second down, 15. Ball at the 17. Sweeney sets him up. 4 minutes and 46 seconds. Again, there's movement on the far side. No flag. Sweeney hit as he throws, and he overthrows everybody incomplete. Intended for Gene Taylor. Sweeney is down. He'll get a helping hand up. Hollis on the coverage, and that was Charles Wiley, number 80, helping him up.
Charles Wiley made a tremendous charge on the inside of the play. Watch Kevin Sweeney. You'll see Wiley come in, and it appeared as though he may be injured. Watch the shot right to the knee. That's how you get some severe injuries. Charles Wiley certainly didn't do it intentionally, but I thought for a minute that Sweeney may have been down with a knee injury, and I think it is bothering him a little bit. He's limping to the sideline. We'll be back.
We will move inside in the Unidome in Cedar Falls, Iowa next Thursday night, continuing our live coverage of college football on Thursdays. Indiana State, the Sycamores, taking on Northern Iowa. And for Northern Iowa, Mike Smith and tailback Carl Boyd are as good as you will see. A great passing combination. That's next Thursday, 9 o'clock Eastern time on ESPN. It's 7-0. The Bulldogs scored here following an interception, a quick 31-yard touchdown run by Anthony Mosley, the fullback. Now looking at a third down and 15. This drive featured a 64-yard pass to Baker, but they had it at the 12. Penalty set them back to the 17. It's now third down. Let's see what Sweeney elects to do. Looks right. Pumps one. Throwing deep. Intended for Taylor. He's got it. Unbelievable catch by Taylor in the end zone. Touchdown, Fresno State.
Well, there's a reason why the Fresno players are all over Taylor on this play. Little hitch and go, but good coverage by number 25, David Hollis. And you can see, number one, watch the concentration. He keeps his eye on the football all the way and goes up and comes down with an incredible catch for the touchdown. Gene Taylor just makes this play entirely on his own. They didn't get the fake that they wanted because Hollis did not bite on the fake. But Taylor just went up and took the football away and comes up with 6 points. And the Bulldogs are playing much better football than they did last week against Fullerton.
So Sweeney notches the touchdown pass. On to notch the extra point is Barry Belli. Sweeney's 13th touchdown toss of the season. Taylor made the catch, 14-zip. They've had some pretty good receivers at Fresno State. How about Henry Ellard and Stephon Page? We're seeing a couple more tonight, right, Gene?
You certainly are. Stephon Page with Kansas City and, of course, Henry Ellard with the Rams. And the people at Fresno say this pair of Baker and Taylor are just as good as those receivers, and that's saying a mouthful.
The kickoff from Belli will come deep to Thomas and Emery. Thomas is the man they want to get it. He backpedals into the end zone. Is he coming out?
He comes out, he goes back in. Do that.
The official rules. Safety.
We got it.
He came out, he went back in, he downed the ball. You were right, Gene, you can't do that.
Well, I know you can't do that because once in my career at Stanford, they put me back there. I came out and my partner back there said, go down, and I went down on about the 1 yard line. So I've seen this mistake before. Can't go out, come back, and I think he was realizing, did I make a mistake? And you certainly did, George Thomas.
Well, it's going to cost them 2 points, and also, Gene, will cost them the football, and they're already down 14-0.
I think he was looking for help from his fellow player back there. Emery looking to see, should I come out, should I stay in? I think he didn't get any sort of hand signal, and he decided to go down not knowing where he was on the field. And of course, he's on the sideline trying to explain it to his coach, Wayne Nunley.
Two more points tacked on. It is 16-0 Fresno State, and we're still in the first quarter with 4:34 to go. Now George is going to reenact what happened. The scoring drive, it took them four plays to go 87 yards. They went 64 to Baker, finished it off with a toss from Sweeney to Taylor of 17 yards for the touchdown. Took 50 seconds off the clock, made it 14-0 on the ensuing kickoff. The safety makes it 16-0, and the Bulldogs, huddling at the 40-yard line, are going to get the football back once again.
John, the Rebels can ill afford to get too far behind this Fresno team, particularly because of the outstanding defense that they have. And when they make a play like this, a real serious mental mistake, then the players can start looking around at one another and saying, well, wait a minute, you made a mistake. That certainly isn't the kind of thing that Wayne Nunley wants, particularly here in their last home game with all these seniors who are graduating. This is not the way they want to have this football game end up, with these types of mistakes.
At the 31, Baker takes the kick of Hulberg, tries to cut it back to his left, still on his feet, and dropped at the 39-yard line. So that's where the Bulldogs will have it, first and 10. Gino Cimarelli made the tackle. Baker on the punt return, and the Dogs will huddle. They've got good field position at the 39-yard line.
And John, in these situations, when you get a play like this and you sort of get the defense a little down in the dumps, that's the time to come up with a big play, or at least an attempt for it. So don't be surprised if the Bulldogs go for it all here on this first play.
Sweeney very close to 100 yards already passing here in the first quarter of play. Again, whistles and flags before we get the play underway. We'll do it again.
John, Stephen Baker is coming off the field, may have injured himself, his right, sort of holding his right shoulder down. I think he has some sort of injury that he wants to get over to the sidelines and have the trainer take a look at. He pulled himself out of the ball game.
Marching back inside, nearly to the 33-yard line. It'll be first and 15, as the referee will let us know.
Ball, procedure, on the offense, first down.
That bet may be off now. This is an entirely different situation. They don't sort of have that momentum going for them. May have changed up if they had a big play set up.
They go on the delay to the fullback, Anthony Mosley, and he has run down for a loss of a yard on the play. Mosley never really got on track that time before he was stacked up quickly. That's Adrian Harris, number 96. Here's Baker. Let's take a look and see what's happening with him.
I think he may have landed on his wrist when he got tackled on that punt. And of course, when you're playing on this artificial surface, it's going to be very hard down there. And if you land on a wrist or an elbow, it can present a real problem.
Second down, still long yardage. Sweeney looking over the middle, is going to be sacked back inside the 25-yard line to the 24-yard line. So that time, Knight got to him. Knight picks up the sack. He has 4.5 on the year. Maybe getting credit with Wiley on it as well. They put the heat on Sweeney that time.
Well, as we take a look at the defensive secondary coverage, very good man-to-man people back here. And you can see that they're pretty good on the Fresno people. No one is open. Kevin Sweeney does not want to turn the football over. He takes the sack, but more importantly, he ducked down and didn't take a real blow from the people that came in to make the tackle. So he's not taking the punishment, the sort of punishment that created the shoulder problems for him.
Third down and very, very long yardage. The pressure on Sweeney once again. He takes a hit as he throws it deep. Up for grabs and intercepted. That's Brock Smith who was tracked there. The intended receiver was Brock Smith. Teddy Nelson was there defensively along with Alvin Horn. 39 and 36 teaming up on the coverage. It'll be fourth and long, and the Bulldogs will have to punt.
Lots of pressure from number 96, Adrian Harris, which creates this situation downfield. Number 39, Teddy Nelson in on the play, and number 9 coming in. They make us do a good job of breaking up the pass, really one that I don't think Kevin Sweeney should have put up.
On the offense, penalty is declined, fourth down.
So it'll be David Hollis deep to receive the kick of Barry Belli. Now recall last Thursday, Belli did not punt the ball very well. He was not the punter at the start of the season. Instead, that was Dave Bass, but it is Belli handling the placements and the punting right now. Let's see how he does as he kicks to Hollis. 2:57 remaining in the first quarter. 16-0. The Bulldogs of Fresno State are growling early tonight. Hollis comes up at his own 36-yard line. Cuts it at the 40 to the 45. A little room as he dances across midfield and all the way down to the 44-yard line. An excellent punt return that time by David Hollis. So Hollis sets him up in good field position. It's a 40-yard punt. They cut that down to a net 20 thanks to the return.
There's a flag down on the field. The officials are huddling.
And we're walking the other way, too, I think, Gene. So instead of having good field position, the clip will push him back. They could have had it at the 44 of Fresno State. It will go back on the other side of midfield. 2 minutes and 44 seconds remaining first quarter. I'm John Sanders along with Gene Washington. There is Wayne Nunley, charged with the job of turning the program around, the theme being we're going to win you over. And Coach Nunley, who was the running back coach last spring, got the job just a few days before the spring game. He accepted the challenge of being the interim coach, and he has also accepted the challenge of turning this Rebel program around.
Which is not an easy thing to do because they certainly had this year of problems here. They were a team that really didn't have a whole lot of discipline, and I think that's putting it mildly, both on and off the field. On the field, they were the most penalized team in the country last year, and he certainly has a task cut out for him, but he's doing a very good job.
So Strip Stallworth sets it up offensively at the 32-yard line. Emery, with a little bit of room, he squeezes it out across the 35 to the 36. 4-yard pickup on the play. Mike Walker made the tackle. James Rivera there as well, number 43, but Walker with the initial hit. 4-yard pickup. Second down, clock running, about 2:20 remaining in the first quarter. Gladney and Williams now are the wide receivers. The fullback trying to get the 40-yard line is Darren Brightman. He won't get there. Just short of the 40-yard line.
And number 5, Michael Stewart.
John, when a defense like the Fresno defense gets into a situation like this where they have a fairly substantial lead built up, this is when they can turn things loose. They can really sort of play with reckless abandon.
Minute 38 left first quarter. Third down, a couple. Brightman will not get the first down, no gain. Brightman quickly wrapped up. Mark Olson, who was hurt last week in the game against Cal State Fullerton. Olson, not expected to start tonight, but he's out on the field and he makes a big, big defensive play there.
And he does it in spite of a sprained ankle. Good job. He's going to be playing, though, only in spotted situations because on this AstroTurf, if you have an injury like an ankle injury, it tends to aggravate it even more. So he will be in spot situations.
And Baker is back out on the field. Stephen Baker.
Number 81, Stephen Baker.
Hulberg with the kick, a line drive kick. Backs Baker up. He fields it at the 21-yard line. He's got some room. Oh, crunching tackle there as he gets across the 35, maybe the 37-yard line before Stephen Baker is decked by Myers. Eric Myers, number 67. Myers, the backup linebacker, made a good hit on the special teams.
Henry Ellard with the Rams, who went to Fresno, is both a wide receiver and a punt returner in the NFL. It's very dangerous, though, as you can see on this play. Stephen Baker runs in there and takes a real pop. It's a tough job when you return punts and also have to start as a wide receiver. Not many people can do that.
First and 10 at the 38. Fullback Mosley, a couple, maybe three, as he powers his way out across the 40-yard line. Clock winding down the first quarter now. We have 37 seconds to play. You saw Brian Kazarian is in there along that front, along with Paul Portese now. Brad Heyer, Mike Withicombe. Jeff Skidmore along that line.
A player down, one of the Rebel players is down on the field injured. Can't quite see his number at this point.
Looks like maybe it's Adrian Harris. Yes. Number 96. The junior from San Fernando, California is shaken up on the play and he'll probably go off. The ball at the 41. 3-yard gain for Anthony Mosley. Mosley tonight with a 31-yard touchdown run to his credit. Still very windy, the wind out of the northwest, and the flags are really stiff right now. around the Silver Bowl here in Las Vegas. Kevin Sweeney looking at 7-7. You can see the final seconds of the first quarter ticking away. Taylor in motion. Sweeney on a delayed handoff to Williams. Williams gets very close to a first down. Out near the 48-yard line, he might be just shy of first down territory for the Bulldogs of Fresno State. And time has expired. The first quarter is history here at the Silver Bowl in Las Vegas, Nevada. 16-0. The Bulldogs are leading. And you look on from behind the bench of the team that's leading right now, the Bulldogs of Fresno State, 16-0. No real surprise, though, that Jim Sweeney's team has jumped ahead, because traditionally slow starting are the Rebels. Only 14 points in the first quarter all year. Third and short. They have two tight ends, Klug and Dugan, in the game. Taylor in motion. Drops the football. Sweeney picks it up and goes for the first down himself. It'll depend on the spot. Williams says yes. Moving up on the other side is Alvin Horn to say no.
Bad exchange between Kevin Sweeney and his center, Brad Iyer. We watch from the end zone. Does not get the ball cleanly. I think on his second surge he makes it, but a lot depends on where the official puts the ball down. Did Sweeney's knee hit down first before he got the ball over the first down mark? And that's what we'll find out as they bring out the chains to make the measure. No. It's going to be an inch shy.
Did not make it. It'll be fourth and short. So Wayne Nunley's defense is held. Let's see what the Dogs decide to do.
Well, they're going for it. They're up by enough points to take a chance in this situation. And they have some awfully good linemen, particularly on the left side, and Mike Chilonson and Mike Whittakum. But of course, Sweeney, with just an inch or so to go, he may just keep it himself and go with the quarterback sneak.
And they go with that heavy tee, the unbalanced line. There's movement on the other side of the line. It looked like Doc Wise, number 93, was even forced over the line by his own teammate as they started to shuffle back there. We'll have a little conference before we decide. Let's take a look. Movement there. Movement on the offensive line. You can see Blue coming up to point that out. What did the officials decide? That's the question. It goes against the home team.
First down for the Bulldogs.
Dead ball. Encroachment, defense, first down.
John, I think the mistake here is that they're not watching the hand of the offensive man. You see, he makes a little move with his head, but his hand does not come up off the surface. That's the key. If he makes a movement and lifts up his hand and starts to move forward, he just moved his hand up a little bit. That's the area of concern, and I think that's why the official said there's no movement on the offense, because his hands did not leave the ground.
On first down, Sweeney to throw. Looking short, in and out of the hands of Baker. First quarter stats look like this. On the scoreboard, it's 16-0 Fresno State, and statistically, let's see how these two teams shape up after the first 15 minutes of play. Here it is. Total yards, a big edge there to Fresno. Of course, as you can see, UNLV leading in time of possession. They had one real long drive, but the problem is, Gene, they have no points to show for their efforts thus far.
John, another thing I think that we should point out is the fact that because Fresno was on last Thursday, they've had more time to prepare for the Rebels than vice versa. So they have spent more time looking at game film. The players have had a chance to heal some of the bumps and bruises, and that has not been the case for Las Vegas.
Second down, 10. Baker and Taylor are both in there. Williams deep in the backfield. Sprinting out across the 45, down to the 43-yard line, a gain of four. Alvin Horn, number 36, pleading his case to the official there. He made the tackle.
That's about the 43-yard line.
And Horn is still doing some talking.
Well, when it rains, it pours, and things are certainly going against the Rebels so far in the ball game. But I can see Horn's point. He had the running back, he had Williams inside the line, inside the inbounds mark, and he had to take him out and make the tackle. I don't think he put an extra effort into it. I don't think he did anything to intentionally try to hurt Williams.
Dead ball, personal foul, there. Defense, automatic first down.
So the call went against number 36, Alvin Horn. It sets up first and 10 at the 28-yard line. The Dogs continue their offensive drive. Sweeney straight back. Now forced out of the pocket. A flag is down as he cuts it inside the 20, dives down at the 16-yard line. But that's thrown in the position, Gene, where we usually see holdings. Back in that offensive backfield. 13:52 to play in the half. Here it is.
Well, the holding indication, but we'll watch Kevin Sweeney. He's had some situations where he's gotten his shoulder banged up. He scrambles out of the pocket. Now watch the decision he makes when he gets all of the yardage that he can get. Okay, give me that hook slide. Safe. In there. All right.
And Alvin Horn right on top of him. Back it up 10.
Holding on the offense. First down.
First down and about 20 yards or so to go. This is a situation where normally you would see a screen or a draw, but because they're in pretty good field position, they may go ahead and throw the ball downfield, and if they do, probably to the inside.
Sweeney looks over the middle, holds it. The pass is complete to Dugan, the tight end. He's inside the 25-yard line before he's dropped. We have another flag down on the play, and again, it's in the backfield area.
Down number 8, John Johnson.
So Chris Dugan, his fifth catch of the season, if it's allowed.
Well, I don't think it's going to be, probably going to be another holding call against Fresno. There it is. There's the indication. And if there's one way to stop the Fresno passing attack, get the officials to point out that maybe they're doing a little holding in the interior part of that line and move them back that way. As they mark off the ball, let's take a look at the play and see if we can find out who's holding. Someone said it was number 78. That's Mike Shalansif. Oh, that's sort of like a little pull-down move in a wrestling match.
Yeah, whenever you see that pull-down, what almost follows automatically is the flag. Ball back at the 47-yard line. It'll be first down and about 29 to go. Somehow or other, I think we've lost a yard here in the penalty shuffle. Sweeney again straight back. Now he runs up, moving out to his right. He's got some room. Now he'll take it to be tackled out of bounds. Jack Moore, number 52, put the collar on him right at the 40-yard line.
Kevin Sweeney was hoping he could get out of bounds before Moore got to him, but Jack Moore showing very good speed. He collared Sweeney over there, and I don't think that any of these players want to intentionally hurt one another, but if you can get a Kevin Sweeney out of the ball game, the way he's throwing the football with his dad looking on, you would certainly like to have him not throwing downfield, not trying to attack your defensive backs, and if you can encourage him to take it easy, you would certainly do that.
Second down, still very long yardage, and again, Sweeney is straight back. He's under the gun. He gets the pass away. It's complete to the Williams on the far side, unless they had blown it dead, and I believe they had. Back at the 41-yard line, Sweeney was down. George Barone in there defensively, but Sweeney will be called for the sack.
George Barone, number 45 from the right side of your screen, does an excellent job of getting in. He beats his man. There, the knee is down just before the ball gets off, and I tell you, not by very much. Not by very much at all. Number 45, 6 feet, 210 pounds, a junior, makes an excellent play.
Came a long way from Miami, Florida to play here. The ball back at the 40, close to the 42-yard line. Each defense now has two sacks. It'll be third down at about 18 miles. Or 36 yards, whichever you prefer. 11:40 to play first half. Mosley, the fullback. Back into Rebel territory to about the 47-yard line, but that's it. It'll be fourth down and still long yardage. Anthony Blue, the five back, came up to make the tackle.
Well, the Rebel defense finally beginning to play the way maybe we thought they would earlier in the ball game. The question now is, have they gotten themselves too far behind to make a real difference? Because this Fresno team is such a good football team. When they get you down, they usually keep their foot on your neck.
Hollis at the 15. still driving to the 25, about a 10-yard return. It'll take an army to get him down. They finally do. The ball at the 25-yard line. The Rebels of UNLV will have it when we return to Las Vegas. John Sanders with Gene Washington. Happy to have you with us from a chilly and windy Las Vegas tonight. Fresno State making it even cooler for the Rebels. 16-0. We're in the second quarter. We have 10 minutes and 58 seconds until halftime. We knew that Strip Stallworth was a slow starter. Indeed, he has been thus far tonight. Looking at first and 10 at the 25. Wide receivers are Thomas and Darnell Woods. Deep down the sidelines. Overthrown, the intended receiver. That was Darnell Woods, number 81. And you can see back on the defense that time was Greg Williamson. Good pressure being applied by David Grayson, the linebacker.
John, when I was playing in the NFL, I took some shots from a fellow by the name of Grayson who played for the Raiders. That's his son, David Grayson, number 45 for the Bulldogs. And I think he took a page from his dad's playbook, coming in with a big play on quarterback Steve Stallworth.
Stallworth is 2 of 8 passing now, 1 interception. Here they come. The blitz is on. Stallworth gets it away. It's complete. Out of the backfield. It is Emery. Down the sidelines he goes. He's got room. Cuts it back and is finally dropped inside the 30. Stewart made the tackle on the play. He was trying to set up a block by Cedric Davis that time, but Emery with a big, big play for the Rebels of UNLV.
This play was made possible by the recognition of the blitz. Steve Stallworth, he sees the blitz coming, gets rid of the football on a little curl pattern to Rod Emery. He gets the ball to the inside and watch this move coming up on the right side. Watch the move right there. Excellent move. Terrific job of running after the catch by Rod Emery.
Gene, you've talked about it over and over. On the blitz, something's going to happen. It may be good, it may be bad, and it was good for the offense that time. 45 yards on the play. Now they go back to the ground. The fullback, Darren Brightman, the freshman who won the job from Icky Woods, picked up a couple.
And number 96.
John, the Rebels coach, Wayne Nunley, said that in order for them to be competitive in this football game, they had to get the ball in the hands of George Thomas, number 3, their wide receiver, the fellow with tremendous speed. And now that they're getting down close, they have an opportunity maybe to get some points on the board. Maybe they're thinking of going towards George Thomas, the speedy wide receiver.
Thomas is to the bottom of the screen, but to the top is Gladney. They go on the delay, this time to Emery. Flag down as Emery dives inside the 25-yard line.
Again, that flag thrown in the area, which would usually indicate holding.
Jethro Franklin, another tackle. And indeed, it will be holding against the offense, so we'll back them up 10 yards. Drive started at their own 25. The big play, the 45-yard pass for Coach Nunley as the pass went to Emery, but they'll back them up 10 here. And here are the penalty totals. 6 for the Rebels, 4 for the Bulldogs. 9:42 left in the first half.
Holding on the offense, second down.
John, as I mentioned before, last year, the Rebels led the nation in penalties. They were not a tremendously disciplined football team. Nunley has done a terrific job this year, though. When you look at the penalties coming into this game, they had only been penalized 74 times as compared to their opponent 61, so they really brought that ratio down.
Not only that, they were penalized 11 yards on that play. Back to the 38. In and out of the hands of Brightman, the fullback. The pass was too tall for him, so it'll be third down and about 18.
But another penalty flag down again in that area in the interior part of the line, which would indicate holding again.
And it's the same problem that plagued the Bulldogs on their last drive. It's an illegal block. Goes against the offense, and we'll back them up another 10.
Number 67, Jethro Franklin, is a sack man. Number 75, Rich Gerard, is blocking on him. That could be where the holding penalty came.
Almost had a face mask. He had his hands up so high that time. They got entwined in that cage. The man who has restored order to the Rebel football program, not happy about what he's seeing in the final home game of the season. 16-0, Fresno State leading. We have 9 minutes and 19
illegal
seconds
use
remaining.
Of the hands on the offense. Penalty is declined. Third down.
So they declined the penalty. The ball stays where it was at the 38. It'll be third and 18.
Third and long. If I'm the defensive coach, I'm going to say double cover George Thomas. Do not let him get the football.
A busted play for the Rebels on third and long. Walker, number 90, right in the middle of things to mess it up for Strip Stallworth. And so the punting unit will come on.
John, oftentimes in this situation, a quarterback is so anxious to get the ball and get back that he steps back and starts back before he actually has a football. That may have been the situation in this particular occurrence. Third and about long, Stallworth thinking, let me get back in the pocket and find my receiver. But it all starts with getting the snap from the center.
That's Rod Webster, the deep man, to receive the kick from Bob Hulberg. Hulberg kicking for the corner. See how well he does. It'll bounce out of bounds. At the 13-yard line, that's where the Bulldogs of Fresno State will have it when we come back to the Silver Bowl.
Yes, it's true. Yes, it's true. I'm so happy to be stuck with you. I can see that you're happy to be stuck with me.
Well, I think every father should get the opportunity to be on the sideline with his son. I've had Father's Day most often throughout 36 years of coaching on the high school and college level. I think it's a privilege to be on the football team with your son, and I feel strongly, as other coaches in America do, that I'm an extension of the parents' arm anyway, so every football coach is worth much, thanks if every football player has a son.
The father and son tandem from Fresno, Sweeney and Sweeney, Jim and Kevin. How do you recruit your son, Gene? You just say, you're going to this school. First and 10 at the 14, 8:32 to play first quarter. Williams for about three and a good line search that time as he got a few more. From the 14, it'll carry close to the 17-yard line.
And John, that combination of Sweeney and Sweeney has certainly fared well in the last couple of years. Just looking at their record, last 20 games, if you look at the last 20 games for Coach Jim Sweeney on the sideline, they're 18-1-1.
Can't beat those numbers.
Oh.
And the Bulldogs still hoping for a bowl. They'd like to go to Anaheim, play maybe Temple in the Freedom Bowl. Be a good matchup. Sweeney and Paul Palmer. Inside 8 minutes left in the first half. They go out of the shotgun. They run out of the shotgun. Williams inside, then outside, and he's tripped up short of the 20-yard line. Leading the way is Alvin Horn, number 36.
Alvin Horn shows why he is the second leading tackler on this team, and from the free safety position, right side of your screen, watch number 36. Comes up and makes a good tackle. Good athlete, 5'11", 180, senior from the Fresno area, terrific athlete.
And right now he's down on the field. About the 23-yard line, I believe that's Alvin Horn who is down. 7:35 remaining first half. It's been all Bulldogs, 16-0. The senior Alvin Horn being helped off the field, and they'll work on him over there. Let's hope it's nothing serious. Otney Wren, number 7, will take his spot in that defensive secondary. They've had a couple of other good ones go down. Charles Dimery, Anthony Drawhorn, but they've continued the tradition. Outstanding defensive backs. The Bulldogs of Fresno State leading 16-0. We had 7:30 to play in the first half. Third down, a long four. Williams cuts it up. Keeps his feet. And Williams gets to the 25-yard line. That should be enough for the first down.
Stop by number 31.
The Bulldogs.
James Williams certainly knew where the first down marker was on that play. Stretched it out, turned it up inside, got some good blocking, but he got those last couple of yards all on his own.
And it was that last surge that carried him just beyond the 25. First down territory for Kevin Sweeney. Sweeney tucks it under. At the 30, he'll cut out of bounds to the 33-yard line, give him 8 on the play. It'll be second down and 2. And if you've got a quarterback like Sweeney, this is the yardage you like. Second down and short, Gene, you can do so many things.
Second down and short is a quarterback's dream and a wide receiver's dream. You go to the huddle pleading for the quarterback, play action, please throw the bomb. Because basically you have nothing to lose if you don't make it here. And if you have confidence in the offensive line, you say, we can pick it up on third down. Let's go for it all here on second and short.
Second and a couple. Should point out that Alvin Horn is back in the lineup. So Horn only out for one play. They go to Williams. He dives across the 35, near the 37, and that should be enough for another Bulldog first down. 6:40 left in the first half. All 16 points came in the first half. The first touchdown set up by an interception as Williams now comes off. And Kelly Skipper is the backup tailback. Williams will talk it over with Sweeney. And there's the son, Sweeney. First and 10. Ball at the 37-yard line. Skipper breaks one tackle. He'll get maybe a yard and a half, and that is all. You see Skipper's totals. He came on, ran quite a bit last week against Cal State Fullerton. He's a sophomore, so he's got some time left. Number 26.
And if he looks small relative to the other players out there, that's because he is. He's only about 5'6". Pretty well put together, though. Weighs 181 pounds and 5'6", 181. He's pretty well put together. Tough player.
He only got about a half yard. There's play action. Sweeney looks down over the middle. He has his man. Upended. Blue made the tackle. That's a tight end, number 41, and we don't have a 41. So unless Dugan or Pflug has changed jerseys, I'm not sure who that is. Pflug has changed jerseys, so he's wearing 41 now instead of 17, and he was wide open down the middle.
Sweeney does a good job of finding him underneath the coverage. He wanted to go downfield. No one open there, and he had to come to Paul Pflug, who holds on and makes a terrific effort of just holding onto the ball because he took a real shot.
It's another first down for the Bulldogs. Mosley gets outside. High steps his way down near the 41-yard line. Alvin Horn on another tackle. So again, second and short yardage. It'll be second down about three. And we have seen a lot of Alvin Horn tonight. He went out with that injury, came right back in. The senior from Hanford, California. That's the Fresno area, and he waits for this game all year long. Second and short, about 2.5. Kelly Skipper has another first down as he dives to the 34. So a good drive for the Bulldogs. Gene started on their own 14. They've mixed it up pretty well.
I think that's a key, John, is the fact that they've mixed up both their runs and passes very well. So what they are doing, they're keeping the Rebels off balance. They don't know whether they're going to come with a run or a pass. And a lot of credit has to go to the fact, really, that Kevin Sweeney is more healthy now and more able to throw those passes downfield with a little zip on them, and that makes a big difference.
Got a first and 10 at the 34. Straight ahead running by Anthony Mosley, the fullback, and he'll lose a yard on the play. Nothing at all in the center of that line. Defensively, they really stacked it up in a hurry. You saw Marion Knight, number 54, get off the bottom of that pile. He had some help in the middle. They stuffed that play. Loss of one, second down, 11. Clock running, we have 3:50 remaining in the first half.
There you get a chance to watch the offense from Alvin Horn's perspective, see how the free safety sees it.
Sweeney, pass complete. Taylor has it. Gets away from one man, he's down at the 15-yard line. Teddy Nelson, number 39, on top of him, but Gene Taylor made the catch. Good yardage, another first down for Fresno State.
Gene Taylor has come up with one touchdown already in the game. A fantastic catch. Free safety Alvin Horn. He's staying at home in the middle. Look at the move. Oh, but when you have the kind of speed that Gene Taylor has, he runs a 40 and 4.5. So when he makes a move back to the inside, Alvin Horn has to honor that move. And you can see that Gene Taylor is a very shifty wide receiver.
Sweeney, 134 yards passing to this point in the game. He's 5 of 9. A little delay that time. They had the first and 10 inside the 15-yard line. We'll unstack them close to the 10-yard line.
Number 36, let's look at it again from the free safety's position. Big hole, people out front, but Horn, number 36, comes in, and there's Skipper. Kelly Skipper tries to make a cut. His feet give way, and Alvin Horn comes up with another tackle.
An excellent pickup, though, on the play. He moved it down inside the 10 to the 8-yard line, so it'll be second down and four. 2 minutes and 20 seconds left in the first half. Skipper, maybe a yard, and that's all. Bulldogs started this drive at their own 14-yard line. They're now inside the 10 of the Rebels of Nevada, Las Vegas.
Number 28.
Fresno leads this series. Sweeney trying to pick up another victory and keep his bowl hopes alive. Fresno State leading 16-0 here at the Silver Bowl and looking for more before halftime. A minute and 55 seconds to play in the first half. A team huddle for the defense of the Rebels of UNLV. Double tight end as Dugan comes in for Stephen Baker, playing the tight end along with Flug. The situation is this. It's third down and three. Ball at the 7. They need to get down to the 4-yard line. What do you think, Gene? Run or pass? It's almost a 50-50 proposition.
I think you're exactly right. But if you have a quarterback like Kevin Sweeney who maneuvers very well, I would like to see him on a rollout.
Instead, we will see Kelly Skipper trying to pick up that first down. Does he get there? No. He's run out of bounds before he gets there. David Hollis, number 25. It'll be fourth and one. Let's see if they go for the field goal or go for six.
Excellent job of stringing this play out. Number 26, Kelly Skipper, trying to get to the outside, but the Rebels don't allow him to get there. David Hollis coming up with a big tackle. Now it's fourth and about one, and we will see the field goal attempt from Barry Belli.
And Belli is 17 of 25 in field goals coming in. He has 2 points tonight. He holds the career record for points, 237, looking for 240. Looks good from here. And it is. The field goal comes with a minute 9 left in the first half and stretches the lead to 19-0. A 22-yard field goal for Barry Belli. He owns his school record, and he now owns the PCAA all-time scoring record, so he knocks home another 3. He pays the price, but he got the 3 points out of it. So there he is. Barry Belli will kick it off now from his own 35-yard line, and he is the all-time record holder for the Pacific Coast Athletic Conference. Thomas, no problem about a safety here. He takes it at the 11. Keeps his feet at the 15 and moves to about the 17-yard line. And that's where the Rebels will have it. One last chance with a minute 2 left in the first half.
And I think that what the Rebels would really want to do in this situation with only about a minute to go is to make sure that they don't create a situation where Fresno gets an opportunity to put more points on the board before the second half ends. I think they need to go into the locker room, regroup, and come out in the second half and try to get things going.
And Eugene Bowen is now the quarterback, number 9, a new quarterback. Eugene Bowen drops straight back. Passes complete to Thomas at the 28-yard line. He's banged to the 30. A brand new quarterback, Eugene Bowen, a sophomore from Los Angeles, comes in to pick it up for Stallworth. Stallworth went all the way last week, but the week before, Gene, they alternated these two men.
Well, Bowen is a better athlete. He is the type of player who can move around very well. He's a big guy at 6'2". I think he's a little taller than 6'2". He appears to be taller than that, but he can scramble very well. And when you get in situations where you're behind and you're trying to create big plays, then you want a quarterback who can create those plays himself. Of course, they had a guy here by the name of Cunningham who did an awful lot of that in years past. And Bowen is a player who is reminiscent of that type of quarterback.
And keep in mind, at halftime, we'll go back to our ESPN studios. Larry Burnett and Beano Cook will be there. They're going to look ahead at the game we have coming up on Saturday between LSU and Alabama. And, of course, on SportsCenter, we'll update all the other activity in hockey and what have you around the country tonight. Larry Burnett and Beano Cook in the studio. And we'll, of course, recap from here, get Gene's thoughts on this first half of play and what adjustments that these two teams will make in the second half. It's 19-0. Jim Sweeney's team is leading comfortably in the first half. Wayne Nunley, all he can do is shake his head. What a way to end your home season, huh?
Well, it's not over yet. Just the first half is nearly over, and they still have a chance. They have the types of weapons on offense where they can strike quickly, particularly in number three, George Thomas, their wide receiver. And with Bowen in the football game, and I would imagine that he would play in the second half, they're not out of the football game yet.
Straight drop. Again, he throws short. Boy, there's a hit. Incomplete pass, it's called. That was Michael Stewart, number five, that just came up and crunched Darren Brightman. Darren could not hang on to the football. So with 48 seconds remaining, it'll be second down.
Michael Stewart, number five, is in a position as we watch the coverage where he can sit back and wait for the ball to be thrown underneath. Then he comes up and delivers a blow. And that's what you call a good fundamental football position. Has his tail down, head up, and strikes through. Good tackle.
We have not seen him go to Cedric Davis, the tight end number 88, and we thought we might. The ball is underthrown at the 48-yard line. Intended for Williams, number 14, George Williams. There's the new quarterback. He's a sophomore from Los Angeles. As you said, 6'2 and a half. He's got the size. He's 180. He's a little bit slender. Thomas, number three, back to the huddle. It'll be third and 10. Ball at the 31, so they're not being shy here in the closing seconds of the first half.
They certainly aren't, but again, they don't want to risk giving Fresno more points before this half ends, so he shouldn't force the ball. If it's not there, don't force it.
Bowen moves up to get away from the pressure. He'll run it. Cuts it back. Works his way across the 40 to the 42. He got a first down with 32 seconds to play in the first half.
Stop line number 35, Dave Wilkerson.
Ryan Greer, number 69, made the tackle, but it's enough yardage for a first down at the 42.
But John, that was a good example of the kind of athletic ability that Bowen possesses. He runs really like a big tight end. Very nifty on his feet.
Again, straight back, protection breaks down, he'll run out of bounds this time, just short of the 45-yard line. Again, it's Greer who ran him out of bounds. And 14 seconds remain, but they've got the clock stopped at this point. 19-0. Fresno State put 16 points on the board in the first quarter. An interception set up a 31-yard touchdown run by Anthony Mosley. At 11:18 remaining, they made it 7-0. Then Sweeney went to Taylor, a beautiful catch in the end zone, 17 yards. It was 14-0 on the next kickoff. Thomas got a little confused about where the goal line was, wound up taking a safety. And with just over a minute to play here in the second quarter, the field goal by Belli, and it's 19-0. Going deep and overthrown, intercepted. That's Greg Williamson, number 28. Williamson will be run out of bounds with 3 seconds on the clock. He aired it out, and Williamson just played it deep and made the interception.
Well, Greg Williamson was in perfect position to make the interception. Bowen just throwing the football up. The problem is he didn't get enough loft into the ball to give Thomas time to sort of run underneath. There you see 28 Greg Williamson, 5'11", 184, a senior, playing for the last time here.
And it's the second turnover in the game. And in their losses, turnovers have been a big factor for the Rebels from UNLV. Williamson comes up with the interception. One last chance. And they'll down it as the clock runs out to end the first half of play. We played 30 minutes here in Las Vegas. A good start for Fresno State. They don't really look like the same team we saw a week ago, Gene.
Well, they turned up the intensity in the second half last week, and I think they've kept it at that level. They've come in, and when this football game began, they were playing like a team that you expect would have a bowl game appearance on the line.
And they are headed to the locker room with a halftime lead of 19-0. We'll be back to Las Vegas shortly. Right now to the studio, Larry Burnett.
All right, thank you, gentlemen. Larry Burnett here in the ESPN studios along with Beano Cook. We're going to be coming up at halftime, kicking around some of the big games coming up this weekend in college football. We'll be doing that when we return. So stay with us. We'll be back here in the studios in just a bit.
when my new
safety drive from their own 14. Those two long touchdown passes setting up a 14-0 lead. They lost yardage and had to punt. Plus yardage, but a punt followed that one. And finally, they drove for the field goal to end the first half. First and 10. Ball at the 44. It's James Williams, the tailback, along with Kevin Sweeney, Anthony Mosley, Baker, Taylor, the wide receivers, the men up front, Heyer, Cortese, Chalanza, Withicombe, Savage. Those are the men up front. Pflug has been playing tight end. Keep in mind that Pflug had to change his jersey. He was wearing 17. Tore that one up, so he's now wearing number 41. Second down and 8 yards to go. Sweeney overthrows everybody, and it's going to be intercepted in the end zone. Alvin Horn has the interception, his fifth of the year, and he's still on his feet. Horn down the sidelines, has some room. Finally knocked down at the 39-yard line. But Alvin Horn, who went out with an injury in the first half, has his fifth interception. That's the first turnover. Sweeney is intercepted now.
Well, John, it appears as though there was some miscommunication between Kevin Sweeney and his receiver. Sweeney throws the ball very long, and there's no one there except for Alvin Horn. Stands there by himself like a center fielder. Comes down with the interception and makes a terrific run back. Does a nice job of running. Certainly miscommunication on the part of Kevin Sweeney and his wide receiver.
Maybe you could see the yellow go down on that replay. That's because there was a penalty after Horn intercepted the ball.
Flipping during the run back. First down.
So the ball will be brought back to the 5-yard line. Horn got the ball back, but not in good field position. Let's see what the Rebels can do. Stallworth is the quarterback.
Well, the Rebels have been known to come back and play well in the second half against North Texas State. They scored on 3 of their first 4 possessions after the half last week. Of course, they have a long way to go here. They're looking at a lot of astroturf, about 95 yards.
Now, last week, here's what happened in the second half. They drove quickly for a touchdown, punted, another touchdown, and a field goal. That was in the second half, the first 4 times they had the ball. They had the punt on their first possession of the second half today. Jones and Woods are the running back. Woods the fullback. And Jones, the senior who was expected to break all of the rushing records but has been slowed by an injury in recent weeks, gets the fullback and moves out across the 10-yard line. What a great story Jones is. He finished his high school career early. He has also already graduated in 3 years here at UNLV. Why? Well, he said, I took 6 classes each semester in high school, so I just kept it up when I got to college. Why not? That's what he was supposed to do. Well, the result is he's already in grad school, and he's still only a true senior in his 4th year.
That's because, John, he's from the School of Scholars and Champions, Long Beach Poly High School.
Well, I knew there was a good reason for it. Second down, about 3. The fullback is stacked up. Icky Woods had the ball.
Number 90, Mike Walker. He has done an exceptional job playing in this ball game, plays on the nose and outside, playing for an injured Mark Olson. Although Mark Olson has played some of the time, he's still suffering from a sprained ankle. Coach Kevin Sweeney on the sideline and watching his charges. There's number 90, Mike Walker. Has done a good job of playing both on the nose tackle and on the outside defensive end position.
A decision coming up for the Rebels of UNLV. They need a couple to keep this drive alive.
The Rebels would like to welcome Royal West Airlines and Class A1.
Bulldogs leading the Rebels 19-0. We're in the third quarter. Still plenty of time. 12:27 remaining. I'm John Sanders along with Gene Washington. Gene, they've had the sideline discussion on third and about a yard and a half. Let's see what they come up with offensively.
Again, they're playing against an awfully good defense, especially against the run. They have Kirk Jones in there. I believe he's in on this play, number 20.
No, they've changed now.
Have they brought Emery back in?
Back to Rod Emery. He is the tailback. Icky Woods blocking in front for him. Strong side is to the left. Let's see what they do. Emery sneaks through for the first down as he gets out to the 18-yard line. Rod Emery kind of sneaked through a crack there and picked up the first down.
Emery gets the pitch to the outside, and he congratulates number 30. Watch the block. Icky Woods, he does the job on David Grayson, although he takes an awful lot of punishment. Nonetheless, he gets the job done. Emery picks up the first down, and the Rebels are out to about their 16, 17 yard line.
Emory now has 24 yards on 7 carries. He's split in the backfield with Woods. Stallworth's throw is complete to the wide receiver near the 20 yard line. That's George Williams. George gets it out to the 25 yard line, a pickup of 7 before Fred Wilburn, number 8, made the tackle.
Steve Stallworth, this football pass will come right into your living room. There it is. You catch it. No, George Williams catches it. That's a tough pass to throw, particularly in college when you're playing on those wide hash marks. That's an awfully long throw. It's about 30 yards in the air for just about a 6-yard pickup. Actually, maybe 30 yards. About 20 yards in the air, though. That's a tough pass.
Second down. Emory, again, following the block of Woods. He takes a good hit from Greg Williamson, number 28, as he gets across the 25 to the 27. Third and a long yard coming up.
John, I think what the Rebels have decided to do is sort of divide this football game into two halves. They're starting the second half not trying to get back in the ball game right away with big plays. They're saying, we're just going to play the second half like it's an entirely different ball game, see if we can get some momentum going on offense and establish something. And once they get on the board, then that might provide that big lift, the big emotional lift that they need.
Bo Bridges is now the tight end. Right up the middle is Emory. He's got room as he breaks out. Across the 40 to the 41 before Rod Webster, number 19, made the tackle, but an excellent drive thus far by the Rebels.
The interior part of that line, the center, Mike Contreras, guard, Robert Orr, tackle, Gerard, they do the job. Good job of blocking and a good job of running by Rod Emory, who has his second start tonight after a terrific performance, picking up 123 yards last week against North Texas State. Gets the call again tonight and has performed very well.
He has 40 yards thus far. The ball at the 41. It is first and 10. Stallworth throws short. Pass is complete. Across midfield goes Emory. Rod Emory out of the backfield to the 49-yard line. That'll be very close to another Rebel first down. Leading the defensive charge was Cliff Henneman.
And leading the charge in a big way, number 77. Watch the hit on the quarterback right from the blind side, but nonetheless, Stallworth gets it away, comes up with the completion. Rod Emory does a little dance, picks up some yardage, and it's close to the first down.
Stallworth now 5 of 13. He's thrown the one interception, and he has 76 yards in passing offense. Tonight, he's going to be just a hair short of another first down. So the quarterback's dream, second and a couple of inches. Let's see what the man they call Strip decides to do.
And when you're down 19-0, I think this would be certainly a good opportunity to try to get on the board. If they don't make it, they're faced with third and about 6 inches. And I think they probably have enough confidence in their offensive line to make that. This would be a good opportunity to go for it.
See what they do. They have converted two third and short yardage situations on this drive. Stallworth again goes short. Emory's got it. Run out of bounds inside the 40-yard line, all the way down to the 35. James Rivera made the tackle defensively, but they're using that play out of the backfield to their advantage.
Well, Vegas cleared out that area on the right side of the field with their receiver, Tony Gladney. He went deep, cleared out that area, and Rod Emory just slipped out into the right flat, beat the linebacker, and picked up the first down.
The ball at the 35, it'll be first and 10. Keep in mind, this drive started at the Rebels' own 5-yard line. 10 minutes and 8 seconds to play third quarter. 19-0 Fresno State leads. Emory on the pitch. A yard, maybe two. And that's it. Franklin was there. Walker was there. Anthony Nunn was there on defense.
A very good drive on the part of the Rebels, but John, usually in a situation like this, when you go from one end of the field moving down, there's a point of where you run the risk of turning the football over. A lot of coaches have the philosophy that if you run 15 plays, you better be in the end zone because the odds are against you holding the ball that long. So we'll see what happens. They've had the football an awfully long time. Let's see if they can get into the end zone before they make an offensive mistake.
And this, at the 33, is the 11th play of this series. Stallworth will run inside the 30. Short of a first down at the 27-yard line, he's wrapped up. Number 69, Brian Greer on the bottom of that heap, along with Anthony Nunn. And we have called Anthony Nunn's name a lot tonight. There is Greer. He got the start because John O'Leary was hurt last week against Cal State Fullerton. Another one of those third and short situations, about a yard and a half to go. Ball is at the 32-yard line. They need, or rather the 27-yard line. They need to get inside the 25. The running backs are split behind Stallworth. Third, a yard and a half, straight ahead. Power running by Woods. He will not get to the first down. He stopped a yard short. Mark Olson, number 59, who's kind of played in spots tonight, and a flag goes down.
Number 96, though, Anthony Nunn, he really stood up the line of scrimmage. He just stopped it right there. Take a look. Number 96, right in the middle of the screen, comes in there. He stands it up. No place to go for Darren Brightman. And so far, they have stopped it, but we have to find out the call from the officials.
It will be against the Bulldogs of Fresno State. They will keep the drive alive because it's going to be a first down. Let's see what happens here. There you go.
Oh, a little karate chop for number 96, Nunn. And there is a flag. Anthony Nunn got a little carried away.
Ball, personal foul, defense, automatic first down.
First and 10 at the 13. The call goes against Nunn. What a great drive for the Rebels here. 8 minutes and 30 seconds left in the third quarter. It's 19-0. The Bulldogs leading the Rebels, but Nevada, Las Vegas is moving. Emory and Woods are the running backs. This is Emory. Inside the 10, he cuts inside the 5 to the 4-yard line. If he'd kept his feet, Gene, he would have scored.
Good blocking on the right side, especially by the guard, Bill Open. Nice job of blocking. Good running by Rod Emory.
And even 50 so far for the senior, playing in his final home game along with 16 other Rebels, and they want to go out in style if they can. They spot the ball at the 5, so make it 2nd down and 2.
John, if the Rebels can get the ball in for a touchdown here, this will have been one tremendous offensive drive.
This is the 14th play on this drive. It's 2nd and 2, and Strip Stallworth calls timeout. With 7:37 to play, third quarter. Right now, UNLV scoreless, but they're knocking at the door.
Playing my last home game as a Rebel football player means a lot. It means that I've went through a lot and endured a lot and been able to overcome a few obstacles. But it also means that this is the end of a career for me as far as playing football since I was in third or second grade. So it definitely means a lot, and I think it means a lot to all the seniors. We're going to come out and play as hard as we possibly can and get this last home win for University of Nevada, Las Vegas, and the whole Las Vegas community.
And this is it for the man they call Strip Stallworth, the senior from Yuma, Arizona, 6'3", 185 pounds. Trying to get his team in the end zone for the first time tonight. 7:37 to play in the third quarter. I'm John Sanders with Gene Washington. Delighted to have you with us on this Thursday night. Keep in mind, we'll be in Iowa next week for Northern Iowa and Indiana State. Join us. 2nd and 2. Ball at the 5. Davis, the tight end, in motion. Fake to Woods. The pass.
Open.
He's got a touchdown. The tight end, Bo Bridges, they were in the double tight. They sent Cedric Davis one way, Bridges the other way, and the Rebels are on the scoreboard.
Cedric Davis is a tight end that you would normally expect to have the ball thrown his way, but instead they go to number 83. I think they fooled the Bulldogs. 6'2", 215, a junior, wide open in the end zone. Stallworth delivers the football, and at 6 points, and the Rebels are on the scoreboard. Little pay action. Ball delivered out there, wide open. 6 points.
A 5-yard touchdown pass. And there is the young man. They call him Bo, Chris Bridges. He caught it for Stallworth, his 9th touchdown of the year. Here is the extra point. It is successful. Kicking it through there is Jim Cook. So, we told you the third quarter has belonged to UNLV. There's one touchdown. Head coach Wayne Nunley is on the board. It's 19-7. Second possession of the second half, he scores. Jim Sweeney saw his offense throw an interception that set up that touchdown drive, but keep in mind, they had to go 95 yards to score. Cook, who got the extra point, will kick off. Kelly Skipper is deep, along with Brock Smith. 7:32 to play. The kick will come to Smith. He steps up at the 14, to the 20, the 25. Cuts it back across the 30. Some room as he gets out near the 37-yard line. It was a long drive, a great drive for the Rebels of UNLV. They marched 95 yards for that touchdown. They earned it all, came up with some big third down plays, and a little bit of a help on a personal foul penalty that added another 15 yards. It took them 13 plays, 94 yards, 6 minutes and 6 seconds off the clock. Stallworth went to Bridges for the 5-yard touchdown.
And I would think what they want to do here is to try to slow down the Fresno attack on the ground, try to stop the rushing attack.
And they go to Williams, the tailback, gets one good block, trying to sprint to the outside, cannot turn it upfield as he's forced out of bounds. And there's that man again, Alvin Horn, number 36.
And he is fired up and trying to get the rest of his troops going. He makes a great play on this particular run. Number 36, watch the way he strings it out, gets to the outside, and watch a little extra effort here. Watch this. There's a little extra effort, trying to get the troops fired up. And if they can shut down the run and force Fresno to put the ball in the air, now they have a chance for turnovers, a chance for interceptions.
No gain. It's second down and 10. Play action.
Pressure.
Gets it off. Complete to Williams. It's going to be a short gain to the 40-yard line. So it's a gain of 3. It'll be third down and 7 coming up. He had to go short. And the reason he had to go short, Gene, he was getting some heat back there.
Getting heat on the pass rush and also the good coverage downfield. This is a key down, third and about 6 or 7, an obvious passing down. If the Rebels can hold here defensively, the momentum really starts to shift their way. And that offense can come back on the field and feel very confident that now both sides of the football team are really doing their job.
It's Taylor to the top, way at the bottom. The pass is complete to William. Nope, he dropped it. Out of the backfield, Williams could not hang on. It's an incomplete pass. The defense has indeed stopped Kevin Sweeney cold.
Number one, Anthony Blue, left side of your screen. There he gets in. He's almost free. Puts the pressure on Kevin Sweeney, throws it out into the flat. And even if Williams had come up with this football, he would have been tackled and would not have picked up the first down. So the Rebels do the job on defense. Now you start to see that little shift in momentum. And as we mentioned before, last week in the second half against North Texas State, the first four times they got the football, they scored on 3 of those opportunities.
Hollis will bring back his third punt. Belli to kick for the fourth time tonight. 6 minutes and 51 seconds remaining, third quarter. The last time UNLV had the football, they marched 95 yards to score their first touchdown. It's 19-7.
They may go for the block.
They're coming. They don't get there. Belli gets the kick away. Hollis wants a fair catch. Gets it at the 27. Keep in mind, our live coverage of CFA football will continue on Saturday night. We've got the Tide and the Tigers, LSU and Alabama. 7:30 is the time for the game. It all begins at 7 with the Mercury Scoreboard Show. Larry Burnett, Chris Berman, and Beano Cook will be there for that. Here we've got a good one going in the third quarter, and it is the senior, Strip Stallworth, Gene, who's led his team back. Doing a good job on that last drive. He hit his last 4 passes. First and 10, the ball just outside the 26-yard line. Rod Emery at the 30, maybe the 32-yard line before he's dropped. Making the tackle is Jethro Franklin, number 67.
Tackle by number 67.
Give him 6 on the play. It'll be 2nd and 4. They have been winning consistently on third down, especially the last drive, and they start out by picking up 6 here.
What makes it easier to convert a third down situation is when you come up on first down and you gain 4 or more yards. Now they're in 2nd and about 4 and 5. They really have the defense at a disadvantage. This is a pass or run down.
Emery with 56 yards rushing now. Take to the fullback. Wide open and dropping another one down the middle is Cedric Davis. Davis at the 45 had another one in his hand. He maybe was turned around a little bit the wrong way, but he could not hang on.
But that's what happens when you get in 2nd and fairly short. Now the linebackers must honor the run fake. Davis is wide open. The ball is thrown a little bit behind him. Maybe he should have come up with it, but the point is that when you run the ball that well on first down, or if you pick up that kind of yardage on first down, now you get into that area where you can play action, and it works very effectively.
Now it's third down. Straight back, Stallworth looks up the middle, has time, flags down all over the place. Stallworth is dropped at the 20-yard line. Getting up is Cliff Hanneman, who was all over him. Got some help from Greg Ramsey, number 87. So 77 and 87 team up that time, but we've got holding. I would assume they will decline it since they've got the ball back at the 20 and it's 4th and 16.
Holding on the offense. Penalty is declined. Fourth down.
Watch number 67 in the middle of your screen, and that's Jethro Franklin. He's being held by Oprin in the middle. The officials catch it as number 77, Cliff Hanneman, comes in and puts a stop on Stallworth.
There's Bob Holberg. This is his fifth punt, averaging just over 35. At midfield is Stephen Baker. Nice kick. Backing Baker up to the 39-yard line. He's got some room on the far side. A lot of room as he goes down the sideline. One man to beat. He can't do it. Baker, though, puts the ball out of the flag down at the 14-yard line. A great return by Baker. Boy, they had the wall set up, Gene.
And there's a clip. There's a clip on about the 14-yard line. The thing that really make this play work, though, was that Baker, in a situation where you might think he would fair catch, gets the ball on the run, gets to the outside, and there's the picket fence. It's set up, but you'll see the clip on number 21. Right there's the clip. A little push from behind. The official is right on the spot, picks it up, and they'll bring it back.
That will knock off part of that 48-yard return of the punt by Baker, and there you see it. He's trying to get some help out in front. From Michael Stewart.
During the run back, first down.
Still good field position, though, Gene. They've got the ball at the 29-yard line. A chance to really snuff out the momentum that UNLV seemed to be building. The blitz is on. Williams picks up four. Down to the 25-yard line.
Coach Nunley trying to put a halt to a possible Fresno drive here, trying to create something on defense. He sent Anthony Blue on another blitz from the corner position. Didn't work because he came one way and they ran the other way. Now, this is a position where Fresno really can sort of reassert itself and get the momentum back on their side. They don't even need a touchdown here, but if they can get 3 points a field goal, that will go a long way towards reestablishing the momentum in their favor.
Mosley and Williams are split. Sweeney will throw in and out of the hands of Taylor. Brian Folland is now the center. Cortese is at one guard, along with Mike Shilantsev. Withicombe at tackle, along with Skidmore. The men up front doing the blocking.
Gene Taylor has one touchdown to his credit in this ball game. Comes to the inside, ball a little behind him. Should have had this one. I don't know if he was thinking about the defensive back coming up to make the tackle on him or not, but he should have come up with this catch. Adrian Harris being helped off the field, number 96.
Third down and six coming up. Chris Dugan is now in a tight end for the Bulldogs. Quick pop by Williams straight ahead. He'll be short of the first down, lost the football. The Rebels think they have it, and they do. Knight came up with it, Marion Knight, number 54, and the Rebels get another turnover, their second one in the third quarter.
This is exactly what they wanted to do, was to keep the momentum on their side. There's the fumble. You can see the ball was loose before Williams went down. The Rebels have come up with a football, and again, this third quarter, as it did last week, belongs to the Rebels.
Trying to find the exact placement of the football near the 21-yard line. The Rebels are quickly out. They want to get going in this offensive drive, but the officials will discuss it first. Sweeney pleads his case and loses. At the 22, it'll be first and 10. So UNLV with 4:38 left third quarter. The turnovers now are even. And both the turnovers, as far as Fresno State is concerned, they have turned it over twice here in the third period. Emery and Woods are the running backs. Thomas to the top of the screen. Woods to the bottom of the screen, number 81. Emery pops to the middle. He's got some room across the 30. At the 35, back outside. Now to the 40-yard line before he's wrestled down. Williamson leads the defense there. Good running by Emery, Gene. He got that crack he needed, and then he really turned it on when he got in the secondary.
John, I think you must get an idea of how good of a runner Kurt Jones, who's sitting on the bench, must be when Rod Emery, who runs this way, did not start until Jones was out with an injury. Bounces to the outside and does a good job of using his blockers downfield and comes up with a big first down for the Rebels.
All the way to the 39. It's a 17-yard pickup. He now has 74 yards, closing in on another 100-yard game. Keep in mind, he didn't start until last week, and he's a senior. The fullback with some room up the middle. Out to near the 47-yard line. That's Icky Woods. His name is Elbert. But Icky picks up good yardage. Jay Wilkerson made the tackle. Spot the football near the 47-yard line. So a gain of 8. They keep winning on first down.
That's exactly right. The Bulldogs, though, are guilty of trying to arm tackle, and these Rebel running backs are not going to be brought down with just arm tackles.
Williams and Gladney are the wide receivers right now. Fake to the fullback. Deep and just out of the hands of Emery. Wilkerson was with him. But check it, Gladney, Tony Gladney, number 89.
Flag down.
It will go against the offense, the illegal block.
That's a tough call against the Rebels. Now instead of looking at a third and about a yard and a half, assuming that Fresno takes this penalty, they'll be going back.
They will take the penalty.
Illegal use of the hands on the offense. Second down.
Ball at the 43. It'll be second down.
Watch number 56, Robert Orr. Number 56 on the right side. He gets his arm tangled up with Greg Ramsey. And when that happens, it's called on the offensive man. That's holding.
And it's only a 5-yard penalty for the illegal use of hands. So it'll be second down and 7. 14 penalties between these two teams tonight. Last year in a Rock'em Sock'em game, there were 31 penalties between the two teams. The pass is complete to the fullback, Brightman. Brightman at the 45, dropped by Troy Fisher.
Dropped by number 53, Troy Fisher.
Not much yardage there. It'll be third and about 5.5.
Fisher did a good job of getting out to the flat from his inside linebacking position on that play to come up with the tackle. Had he not gotten there, it would have been an easy first down for the Rebels.
Thomas to the bottom of the screen, Gladney to the top of the screen. Brightman and Emery the running backs. They switch sides. Brightman, the freshman, is the fullback. The senior Emery, number 43, is the tailback. Stallworth firing. Low and outside and incomplete. So the pass intended for Emery out of the backfield, and you see the reaction of the quarterback. Stallworth thought he should have had his man. He was in a spot to pick up the first down. Couldn't do it. It'll be 4th and 5. So on once again is Bob Hulbert. Stephen Baker will go deep inside his own 30-yard line. There's the touchdown maker. Had a big 64-yard pass reception in the first half. It's set up a touchdown.
But John, the thing that Stephen Baker must be aware of is not to take too many chances. If the people are around him, fair catch the football. Don't take any chances, but he won't have to worry about it on this one.
Now he's going to field it at the 1 and no place to go. He does get outside the 5, and that's it. Not good field position. The Bulldogs have the football. They also have the lead.
Stephen Baker makes a mistake on this attempted punt return. When the ball comes down inside the 10-yard line, the rule is that you should let the ball bounce. Instead, he picks the ball up on about the 1-foot-yard line, tries to get outside, ends up, they're backed up on about the 6-yard line or so. Punt returner, when the ball comes down inside the 10, the rule is to let it bounce. into the end zone and you get the ball out at your own 20. But when you have the ability of a Stephen Baker, sometimes you're anxious to get a hold of that football, thinking that you can do a lot more with it. Coach Kevin Sweeney thinking himself, Stephen, you should have let that one bounce.
It was a 53-yard punt at the 6-yard line, first and 10 for Fresno State. Sweeney not afraid to throw in the shadowy zone goalpost, goes deep, looking downfield for Taylor, and it's incomplete. Right with him on the play. Taylor went up for it, but he had a lot of company. David Hollis, number 25, was there as well.
Davis Holler, the defensive back, number 25, in good position, but that hasn't made a whole lot of difference in some plays before. Gene Taylor, in a play similar to this in the end zone, came up with a play, came up with a touchdown, as a matter of fact. Good coverage by David Hollis, senior, 5'11", 187.
Baker will go to the top of the screen. Here is Skipper, Kelly Skipper, with the football. No place to go. Kelly will lose a yard, maybe two on the play. Moving up to force the play. Good defense that time. Knight was right there, along with Marcus Glasgow.
Number 28, Marcus Glasgow, 6'2", 200-pound senior. Does a good job of coming up from his stud position, they call it. Rover back position on the outside. And here in the second half, they've done a good job, the Rebels have, of shutting down the run against the Bulldogs, forcing Fresno into obvious passing situation. And this is where they can create turnovers.
And they will try to pass. Sweeney is...
Oh!
He lost the football. Whose ball is it? Did they call it a safety or a fumble recovery? Let's wait for the official word. The Rebels think they've got six. I have seen no indication of touchdown from the officials just yet. Let's wait for the call. Alvin Horn right there to help them make that decision. They're going to have to get away from that crowd.
Here's the call.
We have an incompleted pass.
It was not a fumble. It is an incomplete pass. It'll bring up fourth and 11 at the 5 and a break for the Bulldogs.
A very smart play because he gets away with it by Kevin Sweeney. He sees that he's going to be tackled for a safety, so now he throws the football, trying to get rid of it. It turns out, I believe, to be a bad call by the officials because we have the advantage of replay. I think it clearly showed that Kevin Sweeney's knee was down before he got his arm moving in that forward position.
It probably should have been a safety. It's going to be good field position. Hollis, just inside the 50-yard line, brings it back inside the 45 of the Bulldogs of Fresno State. A minute 24 left in the third quarter. We had a call like this earlier, Gene, and they ruled the passer down. Here they did not.
At the least, it should have been intentional grounding. Watch to see if his knee is down. The left knee was down before the ball is out of his hands. It should have been a safety. I believe the official that made the call, I think, was in back and really couldn't see very well. From the end zone, the left knee is down. The ball is still in Sweeney's hands. That is a safety.
At the 44-yard line, first and 10 for the Rebels of UNLV. Down by 12, trying to scratch their way back. Emery, the tailback, no gain. He's banged down. Coming up quickly is Mike Walker, number 90. A minute,
well, John,
10 seconds left, third quarter.
The Bulldogs really got a break on that play. They really dodged the bullet on that one.
At the 45, loss of one, second and 11. How important in your mind is this drive for the Rebels? They need to get some points.
I think you're exactly right. Again, they need to get points, not necessarily a touchdown, just to get points on the board.
Forward, looking deep. Incomplete and out of bounds. That was Thomas, but he ran out of sideline. Fred Wilburn, number 8, running with him all over the field, was right there, along with Rod Webster, number 19.
Coach Wayne Nunley of the Rebels wants to get the football in Thomas's hands. And, of course, with his speed, you'd like to do it going deep. I think maybe what they will try to do coming up here in the next few plays is try to get him on crossing routes, try to get him to beat one of those defensive backs in a man-to-man situation coming across field, which is a much easier pass to complete.
Third down, 11. Thomas has caught only two passes tonight, so they have not been effective getting him the football. Let's see what Stallworth does on third down. Throwing deep down the sideline. out of bounds. It was picked off. Back there was Michael Stewart. He got the football, but he was out of bounds. The deep man was Darnell Woods, number 81. But the entire play was out of bounds, and it'll be fourth down.
Steve Stallworth, the quarterback, simply on this play was trying to avoid a sack, tries to get the ball out of bounds, and fortunately he does that as number five, Michael Stewart, comes up with an interception, but unable to get his foot inside, and now the Rebels are able to punt the ball away. The Bulldogs will field the ball on around the 10-yard line.
And a different man is deep. Rod Webster is deep, replacing Baker, who made the mistake in judgment his last time. Holberg going for the corner. He'll call for the fair catch and hope it gets to the end zone, which it does. 25 seconds left here in the third quarter, and it'll be brought out to the 20. Boy, they did dodge a bullet, didn't they, Gene, with that call in the end zone, and now going to get the ball back at the 20. 19-7 is our score. Fresno State led 19-0 at halftime. Wayne Nunley's crew coming back here in the second half. A long drive, 95 yards for the touchdown. Came on a pass play to the tight end, Bo Bridges. So now Sweeney once again at the 20. 25 seconds remaining in the third quarter before we move on to the final 15 minutes. Kelly Skipper, who does just that, skips for about three to the 23-yard line before he's dropped by Jack Moore, number 52. Time is going to run out in the third quarter before we can get another playoff. That will do it. 19-7, Fresno State leads.
The Fresno State players are not saluting anyone. They're giving the sign four. That means fourth quarter. John, there's a very interesting story behind this. You see all of the players holding up four fingers.
Well, they think the fourth quarter belongs to them. And Jim Sweeney, a disciple of Bear Bryant, had him out to California several times. That is an Alabama-type tradition. The third quarter, let's face it, did not belong to the Bulldogs. It belonged to the Rebels. So their coach, Wayne Nunley. Let's see if Fresno State can get the momentum back. They have a second down and seven. Ball at the 23-yard line. We're in the fourth quarter. Brooks and Skipper are the running back. Sweeney will air it out. Baker ran into the defensive man back there, not able to come up with the football. Teddy Nelson was back there on defense for Baker.
Teddy Nelson is a player who in the secondary has played every position, both weak safety, strong safety, cornerback. He's in good position. If anything, it could have been called interference against Baker, but not much harm. The official decided not to throw a flag. Good job of coverage by Teddy Nelson.
The old NBA rule, no harm, no foul.
That's exactly right.
But we did have a flag down on the play, and we are going to have a penalty marked off. It'll go against Fresno State. Sweeney takes a look at the sideline to see what they're going to do. I believe they're going to back him up 10 yards. So the football will go back to the 13-yard line, replay the down, and let's get the call from our referee.
Holding on the offense, second down.
All right, Jack Gatto has given us the call. The ball at the 13. It's second down and 17 now.
Perfect situation for the defensive backs from the Rebels. They're good athletes back there. This is an obvious passing down. They have the Bulldogs backed up. And they have created a penalty on the Bulldogs because they threatened the blitz. Number one, Anthony Blue, came in like he was going to blitz. And I think he forced one of the Fresno players to jump off sides. Illegal procedure.
Disregard the flag. There is no penalty.
Thank you.
Well, that's interesting. Fly.
Took care of that. So it'll still be second down and 17. The ball at the 13. Kevin Sweeney and his offense going the wrong direction right now. Nevada, Las Vegas, 102 yards of offense in the third quarter. Fresno State had 16. And this time they will get the call. Mixing up pretty good along that line of scrimmage. Shalonstep that time hooking up with Marion Knight, number 54. You can see the discussion. We told you at the beginning, this is a good rivalry. These two teams do not like each other. George Barone talking to Kevin Sweeney, and let's see what happened.
Illegal procedure on the Bulldogs. Number one, Anthony Blue in your picture now. He again came inside on the blitz. The play is over. There's number one. Maybe he didn't see the whistle or hear the whistle in any event.
Nonetheless, he comes in and knocks Mr. Sweeney to the ground.
Well, for that, he paid the price, and he's going to lose five more yards.
Dead ball, illegal procedure, offense.
It'll be second down and 22. The ball at the 8, and Kevin Sweeney is not happy. Neither is his dad. 14:50 remaining in the game.
I would think they would want to keep the ball on the ground in this situation.
Blue sneaking up, but does not come. Williams out near the 14-yard line. Kelly Skipper out near the 14-yard line. Skipper and Brooks are the running backs right now. Marcus Glasgow made the tackle. There's the young man. He is so small. He's 5'6", 175. He can almost hide behind those blockers.
He's short, that's for sure, at 5'6", but you might not say he's small because he's so well put together. That 181 pounds at 5'6", he's like a little bowling ball. He's a tough player, tough to bring down.
He's got the ball again. Cannot get away at the 22-yard line. It'll be fourth down coming up. He picked up eight more, but it'll still be fourth down. Anthony Blue, number one, made the tackle.
Now, he's a player who's small. He's 5'9", but he's only about 170 pounds or so. But he's all over the field. He's a tough player, and he plays a position that requires an awful lot of tackling. He's not back in the defensive secondary. He plays up much like a linebacker. That's a tough job for a fellow who only goes in at about 175 pounds.
High snap to Belli. He gets the kick away. Hollis in good field position at the 42, takes it. No place to go. Too many white shirts. He goes straight ahead to the 46-yard line. That's where the Rebels will have it. They're down by 12 and trying to come back. You think Wayne Nunley's team didn't own the third quarter? Look at those numbers. Indeed, they did.
They've certainly turned it around, and they've also turned their quarterback situation around. Eugene Bowen is now in the ball game. He came in just before the first half ended.
Hit one out of four, threw the interception right before halftime. Let's see what he can do. Emery and Brightman will be the running backs.
Well, we know that he can run with the football.
That's Davis shifting over. Thomas to the top of the screen. Gladney to the bottom of the screen. They go instead to the tailback. Emery picks up a couple as he moves to about the 48-yard line. Greg Ramsey made the tackle. They shuttle in Williams. Thomas goes out. Second down, 8. Clock moving with 13:12 to play. We're in the fourth and final quarter here at the Silver Bowl in Las Vegas, Nevada. I'm John Sanders with Gene Washington, and we're delighted to have you with us tonight. Under the gun, he gets away from it. Bowen still on his feet, pointing out blockers, dancing out of bounds at the 49-yard line. And a crushing block by Davis as his quarterback went out of bounds. Where did they spot him? They spotted him at the 47, so he actually, all of that business, wound up losing a yard on the play.
He would have lost a lot more than that had he not had the ability to scramble as well as he does. He's a big, strong quarterback and really broke free from a tackle. Now they're faced with a third and about 9. Could have been a third and about 15.
Thomas to the bottom of the screen. To the top is Gladney. Passing situation, 3rd and 9. Bowen, straight drop. He's under the gun. And they've got him. Inside the 40 to the 39-yard line. Hanneman was there. The initial surge went by Bowen, but filling in from behind, Grayson and Hanneman pick up the sack.
Jethro Franklin, number 67, as we watch Cliff Hanneman come off the field. It was number 67. Jethro Franklin in the middle of your screen. He breaks through, forces the quarterback Bowen up into the middle of the pocket, and that's where the sack occurs. Now the Rebels have to punt the ball away to the Bulldogs.
Webster is deep again. Holberg will kick. Nice kick. Webster will track it down at his own 16-yard line. Upended, and a flag goes down as he gets to the 24. We'll sort it all out when we come back to the Silver Bowl in Las Vegas. Fresno State leading 19-7 over UNLV. We'll await the call before we sneak away. The ball is spotted right at the 24-yard line. Indication up here that possibly Chris Dugan was caught for the clip. But we will get the official word from Jack Gatto. Offsetting penalties.
Let's see if we can see the clip. Oh, flagrant. Number 84, Dugan. That was very flagrant and right in front of the official. He couldn't miss that one.
Personal foul against UNLV.
And we had a personal foul the other way against the Rebels. The clip will take it back.
All clip during the run back.
So the ball is at the 12. Now we're going to go back the other way. So they gained a couple of yards on the play because of the penalties. The
yellow ball, personal foul on the defense. First down.
So it is first and 10 at the 27. In the second half, you see the numbers of Kevin Sweeney. He had 135 yards in the first half. Almost nothing in the second half. First and 10 at the 27. The Bulldogs have had nothing going offensively. Straight ahead running by the fullback. That's Brooks.
And off the 37, Anthony Mosley.
And I think that we may have a situation where Fresno is beginning to become a little conservative here in the fourth quarter. And you pit that against the aggressive play of the Rebels defense. And Fresno is not operating the way they did in the first half. I think if they want to throw the football against this Rebel team, they should probably do it on first down.
That is Anthony Mosley back in there at fullback. This is complete to Gene Taylor. He takes a good crack from Jack Moore, but not before he picks up the first down. He's out near the 44-yard line.
But there's a penalty flag down on the far side of the field.
And it's in that backfield area.
And judging by the Rebel players, the call is going to go against the Bulldogs.
A personal foul. And that will set them back probably inside the 20-yard line. Judging on where the flag is, the flag was thrown right at the 27. The line of scrimmage was the 30. And we still have 11-18 to play in this football game. The Bulldogs and the Rebels battling it out here in the Silver Bowl in Las Vegas, Nevada. Fresno State.
Personal foul, throw to the head, during the pass, first down.
Now I'm trying to figure out how it can be first down.
We'll watch from the end zone.
On the 13-yard line, second and seven.
Put into my numbers, it's got to be second and about 20. More than that, probably. Flags all over the place. It's getting a little bit confusing down there right now.
I think, obviously, what the call was, I think they called a play against one of the offensive linemen for using a hand, maybe to the head or face of one of the defensive linemen. That's the only thing I can think of.
Dead ball, procedure, offense, second down.
The ball at the 9-yard line, it's second down. And 28. They're the penalties. They're starting to mount up. There's a lot of bad blood between these two teams last year. That game was won by Fresno State on their way to the California Bowl. Two previous years before that, the Rebels had won. Skipper with some room up the middle. Across the 15, close to the 19-yard line, a gain of 10. Still be third down and long yardage for the Bulldogs.
Kelly Skipper gets a big hole up the middle and picks up a nice gain, but
I still think that the advantage at this point in terms of the psychology of the ball game is on the side of the UNLV Rebels. I get the feeling that Fresno at this point, they've sort of relaxed a little bit. They say, we're leading in the ball game. The intensity level has been sort of toned down a bit, and as a result, they're making mental mistakes as opposed to physical mistakes here in the fourth quarter.
Sweeney with play action on third and long. The protection breaks down. Sweeney trying to get outside, can't do it. He's wrapped up as he tried to move outside. Marcus Glasgow, and a flag is down.
And I think that penalty is going to go against Marcus Glasgow for putting a little extra effort in it when he tackled Kevin Sweeney.
And that will be bad news for Marcus Glasgow, because traditionally for Coach Nunley, when a player is called for a personal foul, he is finished for the evening. He comes out of the ball game. We'll see what happens to Marcus Glasgow.
Well, it was really unnecessary.
Personal foul, automatic first down, the foul is on the defense.
The ball comes out to the 31.
I think what happened, John, as you look at the replay, it really wasn't as bad as you thought it was initially. When you saw his arm go across, it appeared as though he was sort of giving a forearm shiver to Sweeney, but when you saw it in slow motion, it really wasn't the forearm that came in there. He really didn't hit Sweeney with it, but it appeared as though he had the intent to sort of hurt Sweeney, and that's where the flag was thrown. I think it was more on the intent than actually the damage of that play.
And Coach Nunley is livid. The down marker shows third down. The referee called first down at the 31, and the natives are getting restless here at the Silver Bowl. We still have 9:48 to play, and the issue not truly settled yet. Sweeney unable to get his offense on track. Nunley's team owning the third quarter, and we are going to have a discussion, move the markers, change it to first down, and that's what it'll be, first and 10. Ball at the 31 after all of that. Sweeney, straight drop. Short and incomplete. Intended for Skipper out of the backfield, Sweeney wound up on his backside.
John, the Bulldogs just aren't playing the way they played in the first half. They're simply, I think, mentally coasting at this point. They're not playing with the same intensity. That's not to take anything away from the Rebels, but they're coasting in a way, I think, just trying to run out the clock here and trying to keep this lead they have and not lose the ball game as opposed to continue with what they had in winning it.
Skipper gets it across the 35, across the 40. He's got a first down at the 43-yard line. The little shovel pass to Kelly Skipper. Myers made the tackle, but not before they picked up good yardage. Todd Cooks on defense as well, but it's a first down.
Good play selection, expecting the pass. Sweeney goes back, a little shovel pass to Kelly Skipper on the inside. And as I mentioned before, he has good leg strength. In spite of the fact he's only 5'6", he's well put together, 180 pounds, very compact player, tough to bring down.
19-7 is the score, 9:28 to play in the game. We'll be back to Las Vegas, Nevada. Fresno State got off to a great start, 16 points in the first quarter. They led 19-0 at halftime, but the third quarter belonged to the Rebels of UNLV. Fourth quarter, well, still up for grabs. Coach Nunley looking at 9:28 left on the scoreboard, down by 12 points. But Fresno State has the ball, first and 10 at the 43, and some straight-ahead running that time by the fullback Anthony Mosley.
If the Bulldogs aren't careful, though, they're going to allow the Rebels to get back in this football game in a hurry, because they're being awfully conservative on offense, and maybe they should try to run down some time on the clock, about 9 minutes to go. But this Rebel defense has been very aggressive, so I wouldn't be surprised at all to see them put pressure on the Bulldog offense and maybe come with some blitzing.
4 yards on that first down carry. Seen a lot of Kelly Skipper here in the second half, not much of James Williams. Sweeney will throw. Has Taylor out of bounds. Check it, it is number two, Rock Smith, picking it up for Stephen Baker right now. So Smith out of bounds. He got across midfield. We have a penalty, roughing the passer. It is getting a little rough out there.
But we expected this to be a rough football game as Kevin Sweeney surveys the situation. Beginning to air it out a little bit more. Adrian Harris was the man who was guilty of
roughing Sweeney after the deliver the football to Brock Smith. 96 red, bottom of your screen. Sweeney delivers the football, and he delivers a helmet. And the official is right there. That's a personal foul. And the ball is on the UNLV 43-yard line.
So the completion on the pass play moves it to the 43, first and 10. 8 minutes and 41 seconds remaining in the football game. This is Skipper. Powering his way near the 40-yard line before he's gang-tackled.
And up to number 26, Kelly Skipper.
Second down, 7. The ball at the 40. There's Skipper. He's just a sophomore, picking it up for the senior James Williams here in the second half. You can see Brock Smith, number 2, is in the lineup right now.
John, I would think the Rebels, if they are going to use their blitz to try to create something, they want to do it in this area to keep Fresno out of field goal range, to try to stay within 2 touchdowns of winning the football game.
Sweeney's pass is knocked away by David Hollis, number 25, intended for Brock Smith, but Hollis is right there on defense. Another flag is down. Let's see what the call is here. They're going to wear out the yellow. Offside on the defense. They'll take it.
But at least the Rebels were trying to create something. They came with a blitz from their cornerback, Teddy Nelson, but one of the interior people jumped a little early. We'll get the call from the official.
Defense, offside. Second down.
It'll be second and short instead of second and long. The 5-yard penalty moves it to the 35. Second and 2.
John, the importance of trying to keep Fresno out of field goal range here is that if Fresno gets down and gets a field goal, they'll move up to 22-7. Then that puts them more than 2 touchdowns ahead of the Rebels.
Kelly Skipper with some room, dancing away inside the 20. Inside the 15 to the 14-yard line before Hollis made the tackle, but good running that time by the sophomore from Eugene, Oregon.
Kelly Skipper, inside the 15-yard line.
Kelly Skipper, the little man, number 36, Alvin Horn, who usually makes a lot of tackles, does not come up with this one, gets fooled a little bit, reaches out with a hand, but that won't do the job against Kelly Skipper. He has now gotten the Bulldogs down into field goal range. Certainly within field goal range with a kicker like Belli, and now they're threatening to take it in for 6 points.
Here's Skipper with some room on the right side. He turns it upfield inside the 10, down near the 7-yard line before he's dropped on the play. Malcolm White, number 44, the junior from Redlands, made the tackle. He's in there with Knight, Wiley, Barone, Cooks, Moore, Glasgow, Nelson, Blue, Horn, and Hollis. They've done most of the work. Most of the work running the football for Fresno State has been done by Kelly Skipper here in the second half. Good yardage there, a pickup of 7. Skipper now has 69 yards rushing in the second half.
In the past couple of games, it's been James Williams who's carried the load running the football. But Skipper has certainly done a job in this ball game.
Here's Skipper again, dancing over one man and right into the arms of another defender. He danced away from Glasgow that time, but right back into the arms of Marion Knight. Might have lost a couple yards on the play, or maybe a yard anyway.
Stop by number 54, Marion Knight.
Spotted at the 8, third down, 4.
Third and 4. Will Fresno keep the ball in the middle of the field, run the ball, get good position to kick the field goal? And as I said, that would put them up 22-7. Then the Rebels would need more than 2 touchdowns to move ahead. Or will they take a chance and go for 6 points?
That's Taylor in motion. The pitch comes the other way. Skipper Kelly cannot get back to the line of scrimmage. He's rolled up. Alvin Horn leading the defensive charge. He lost a couple more to the 11. So it'll be fourth down. They did not keep the ball in the middle of the field.
Actually, I'm a little surprised with the way the hash marks are in college football. When you run a sweep and you get to the outside, if you don't make the first down, now what you have is that you have that angle to kick from, and that's a little different than it is in pro football. Those hash marks are a little further out than they are in pro football, but maybe this is the angle that they want their kicker Belli to kick from.
It'll be a 28-yard field goal attempt, and you can look on with us. It looks good. Is it long enough? Yes, it is. So Belli is true from 28 yards out. It is 22-7, a 15-point lead for Fresno. ESPN's live presentation of Thursday Night College Football has been brought to you by Mercury, the shape you want to be in, and by the U.S. Armed Forces. It's a great place to start. We have 5 minutes and 14 seconds remaining. There was a penalty on UNLV after the extra point. 22-7 is the score, after the field goal. So the ball will be brought out to the 50-yard line, and that is where Belli will kick it. He just kicked a 28-yard field goal, so the kickoff will come from midfield. The scoring drive was aided by a penalty, and a penalty that was called on Glasgow that really kept the drive alive, and they moved it down and took it in. Marching for the field goal, they did not get the touchdown, but they ate up some time off the clock, and they got the field goal on the play. Belli's kick will come to Thomas. He takes it about his own 3-yard line. Thomas is knifed down as he gets across the 10. That was the backup fullback, Kelly Brooks, who came in to slice his feet out from under him. So the ball will be at the 11. That's where the Rebels will have it. They will go again with Eugene Bowen as their quarterback.
And with 5 minutes, 9 seconds to go in the football game, they don't have an awful lot of time, and I would suspect that Bowen will try to create something by running the ball himself from a passing situation or try to get the ball downfield long.
He goes to Rod Emery out of the backfield. Up to close to the 18-yard line. Cliff Hanneman made the tackle, a gain of 7. It'll be 2nd and 3. They'll have to work quickly too, Gene, because that clock keeps on rolling.
John, I would think that they would want to go into a 2-minute offense, call 2 plays in the huddle instead of wasting time going back to the huddle after each situation.
Emery on the delay. He's got the first down and more. Bang down as he crosses the 40-yard line. The hit came from Byron Nichols, but not enough to slow down Emery, who already had the yardage out to the 41. Good pickup on the play of 23 yards.
Very good play selection in an obvious passing situation. Bowden hands the ball off to Rod Emery. Good block by number 32, Darren Brightman. Emery gets out to about the 40-yard line.
First down play. They go to the screen pass. It's complete. Emery breaks it down the sideline. Finally run out of bounds as he gets inside the 30-yard line.
Number 43.
He carried the mail that time. Michael Stewart over there to help force him out of bounds on the play, but it's been all Emery on this drive, and they've moved right down into scoring position quickly.
Again, good play selection. First it was a draw, now the screen play. Rod Emery will take the screen right side of your screen. Good blocks by the offensive line. Good move to the outside, and Emery runs out of gas a little bit, nearly stumbles and falls, but manages to get down to about the 29-yard line, and they are in good position to put some points on the board.
Emery has 98 yards rushing, 112 yards pass catching, and he gets the football once again. No gain on that play.
This was not a good play call, John, and I'll tell you why. They gave the ball to Emery once again, and if we can see it on a replay, you will see that he simply goes down. No one tackles him at all. The fact is, he is tired. You just can't run the ball that much without being a little winded, and they go to the well once too often. Watch, he gets the football here.
He's struggling to get to the line of scrimmage.
The man is tired. Went to the well once too often.
Second down, 10. This time, ball is under some rush, gets the pass away, it's overthrown, intended for the fullback there in Brightman. Let's talk about that defense right now with Ramsey, Walker, Atade, and Franklin up front. They are stiffening, trying to stiffen along that front wall. Hanneman, Nunn, Wilkerson, the linebackers, Williamson, Stewart, Webster, and Nichols now in that defensive secondary. Dustin Quinton is in now at the strong tackle. Bill Oprin, Mike Contreras, Robert Orr has played a lot of guard tonight, along with Rick Girard. Those have been the men up front for the Rebels of UNLV, who have a third down and 10. The pass is short and incomplete. intended for Bo Bridges, the tight end.
Bridges, the intended receiver for UNLV.
So Bowen now looking at a fourth down call. He'll come off. They will attempt the field goal. Jim Cook, number 17, will get the call. The kick is going to be a pretty long one. It'll be about 46 yards. From behind, you can join us at 3:28 to see what Cook does with the field goal attempt. It's blocked and picked up. Running out of bounds on the play. It's Rod Webster, number 19. He picked it up after it was blocked and headed for the sidelines. It appeared that Byron Nichols got a piece of the ball. They really smothered the play. Webster's the one that picked it up and ran it out of bounds, but 3:20 remaining in the game. The Bulldogs starting to breathe a little bit easier now. They've got the football back, and they've still got a 15-point lead.
Jay Wilkerson, number 35, was one of the players in there early. Let's watch as they attempt the field goal. Right in the middle of the screen, someone jumps up high, knocks the ball away, and I believe it was 35, Jay Wilkerson, who made that block.
Wilkerson and Nichols.
Defense, first down.
Well, the penalties are really piling up, aren't they?
Personal foul against UNLV.
It's a personal foul against UNLV. So the ball will be at the 40, almost the 44-yard line now. Sweeney looking, and he's wrapped up. That's Grayson all over him. Check it, George Barone, number 45, made the sack back near midfield. They'll lose five on the play.
I'm a little surprised that Kevin Sweeney selected to attempt to pass the ball on that play with around 3 minutes to go in the ball game. You would think they'd want to just keep it on the ground. Force UNLV into a situation where they would use up their timeouts.
Each team has sacked the opposing quarterback four times. The ball just outside the 50. Second and 15. On the ground this time, Williams bobbles it, gets it back. It's inside the original line of scrimmage, down to the 42-yard line. So it'll be third down and seven. Clock running, 2:15 to play.
The pitch, James Williams bobbles it. The pitch is a good one from Sweeney right back into his hands, but I think that Williams was looking for his hole instead of concentrating on bringing the football in and nearly turns it over, but instead they have a third down, about a third and eight.
Williams comes off. First man to get there on defense was Adrian Harris. Inside 2 minutes now. 22-7, Fresno State. Trying to stay alive in that PCAA race. Oh. Good running by Skipper.
Oh.
He's still on his feet. He can score. Skipper at the 10. It's a foot race now. He'll take it down and in for the touchdown.
Number 26, Kelly Skipper.
A great run by Kelly Skipper. Looked like he was going to get about 5 yards. He took it all the way for the touchdown, a 42-yard touchdown run.
We talked earlier about how strong Skipper is in spite of the fact that he stands only 5'6", but in that 5 feet 6 inches is 180 pounds, and most of it is in his legs. You get an idea of how strong he is from the waist down, breaks three or four tackles, and goes in for 6 points. Terrific job of running by Kelly Skipper.
He's had a great second half. Over 100 yards rushing in the second half. 110, as a matter of fact. That's a full night's work for anybody. The extra point attempt to follow with a minute 34 on the clock. Trying to stretch it to 29-7. They do. 29-7 is the score. The Bulldogs of Fresno State have broken it open here in Las Vegas. UNLV could not keep its second half heroics going. It's 29-7. Fresno State has come up with 10 points here in the fourth quarter. They led 19-0 at halftime. the kickoff will come to Thomas at the 6. And spin away at the 20. He's gang tackled there. So right at the 20-yard line, it'll be first down for the Rebels of UNLV.
John, if you want to know why that last run by Kelly Skipper was so successful, watch number 78, Mike Jelantsev. He comes out. There he is on the trap. Terrific block as he takes Marcus Glasgow out of the play. Kelly Skipper breaks for the touchdown.
42 yards for the score. It's 29-7. We'll be back.
We'll be home. We're coming home.
See you in Hawaii.
A minute and 27 seconds remaining here at the Silver Bowl in Las Vegas. I'm John Sanders with Gene Washington. It is 29-7. The Bulldogs from Fresno State are going to push their PCAA record to 5-1. Still, they are in the hunt. San Jose State leading. They're undefeated, but keep in mind that San Jose State has also lost their quarterback. That could make a difference. Really, all San Jose State has to do, though, to go to the Cal Bowl is to win one of their remaining two games. The thing that you have to think about if you're Fresno State is the possibility of another bowl. There's been a lot of talk about the Freedom Bowl because they can take a lot of fans there. They would love to go to Anaheim.
Procedure, offense, first down.
And in addition to that, John, they have a marquee player in this man's son. That's head coach Jim Sweeney. And, of course, we're talking about the quarterback, Kevin Sweeney.
And Kevin tonight with 150 yards. He has still not overtaken McClure. He's just behind him and still needs well over 300 yards to pass the record of John Flutie. It's knocked down. Incomplete. James Rivera had it right in his hands. Could not hang on. It'll be second down. A minute and 20 to play here. We invite you to join us. We'll be at Northern Iowa next week inside the Unidome. Northern Iowa, outstanding team, taking on Indiana State. So you'll see the Sycamores. Out of the backfield, the pass is complete to Darren Brightman, the fullback. Brightman out of bounds at the 20. That's the original line of scrimmage.
John, the score of this ball game, Fresno 29, UNLV 7, is very similar to the score of last year's ball game, in which Fresno won by a score of 26-6. So in a game that appeared as though it might be a lot closer, turned out to be more reminiscent of the game last season.
And the final minute and 15 seconds for 17 seniors here for the Rebels of UNLV. The sack. Bowen is dropped by Rod Webster. Webster coming up from the defensive secondary, sneaking around the outside and sacked him back at the 10-yard line. So it is the end of the road here at the Silver Bowl. That is Bustamante, I'm sorry. Bustamante made the sack back at the 10. They're going to kick it away. Clock winding down with 48 seconds to play.
Let's go, Frankie!
And so the senior season ends for a lot of outstanding athletes here at UNLV. They have a couple more games remaining, but they will play those games on the road away from the Silver Bowl. They will play at New Mexico State next week and on to Hawaii. For Fresno State, Baker back in there to take the kick. Got some room down the right side. If he can sneak through, he does. He's got room down the sideline, inside the 40. He could go all the way. He's got a convoy. Stephen Baker for the touchdown.
And if the penalty flag is against the Rebels, it'll be 6 points. But yet, that remains to be seen. There's a flag on the field. We'll have to wait to see who the call is against.
Illegal procedure goes against the defense. It'll be a 66-yard touchdown return. It comes in the closing seconds, and Stephen Baker, the touchdown maker, did just that.
Baker nearly got away with one earlier. Heads up, field draws the people to the inside, and you see the picket line, the wall forms to the right as Baker breaks a couple of arm tackles, and now it's all over but the shouting as he just stretches it out and eases into the end zone. Another 6 points, but of course it was academic at that point.
66 yards he goes for the touchdown, the extra point. You try to push it to 36-7. You look back in the years to come at this one and you say, piece of cake for Fresno State. That wasn't exactly the case.
That's exactly right. This score really not indicative of the way three quarters of the ball game went, but nonetheless, Fresno came in with an awful lot of intensity, something they didn't do last week. And they established their dominance in the early part of this football game. And in the fourth quarter, they stretched it out and they will go home with another victory.
They'll go home happy with some time to rest up before their trip to Hawaii. Here it is again. The over-the-shoulder catch, he's made a few of those, hasn't he?
And again, the comparison between Baker and Henry Ellard, who played his collegiate football at Fresno State, now with the Los Angeles Rams, and Henry Ellard has certainly done his share of performances like this one. As Stephen Baker stretches it out, 6 points.
I'll tell you what, Gene, too, when he got through that first wall, that little crack there where they had four men around him, and he went through, you saw the opening, and you can see the look of disappointment on the face of Coach Wayne Nunley, winding up his first year as the head coach. And he's going to have a loss in his final home game of his rookie season.
All over my head, deep in my heart, down in my toes, I got that Bulldog spirit. All over me to stay.
No Grammys, but they're going to get a victory out of it tonight.
They may come out with a video, though.
Coach Jim Sweeney pacing the sidelines. This will be career victory number 126 as a head coach, his 69th. Flag goes down as the ball goes out of bounds. 13 seconds to play, but it's really all over. We're just playing out the string.
John, one of the things, though, that hurt the Rebels most tonight was something that haunted them last year, and that was an excessive amount of penalties. In a couple of situations, it really hurt them tonight. It put them out of the ball game, extended some Fresno drives. But I think that their coach, Wayne Nunley, has gotten something started here that should certainly carry over next year. He has a nucleus of a good ball team. And while they wanted to win this game for the 17 seniors who are graduating, they don't really have anything to be ashamed of in losing to a good Fresno team. And as we mentioned before, the score is really not indicative of the way the football game has gone.
31 penalties between these two teams last year, 26 tonight. They've been hitting late, they've been hitting often. Not always cleanly. The ball is loose. The officials will rule he was down on the artificial surface of the Silver Bowl with only 6 seconds remaining. One more play for the Rebels of UNLV and their home schedule will be complete. Their victories this year were over Portland State, Wisconsin, which may have been the biggest win they've ever had, 17-7 right here in the Silver Bowl. And it was right after that game that Nunley got his new 3-year contract. They came back to beat Cal State Fullerton last week. A breathtaking victory over North Texas State. That is it. We are out of time here at the Silver Bowl. 36-7 will be your final score, Gene.
James Williams had carried the load running the ball for Fresno coming into this football game. Kelly Skipper, he did it tonight as he goes across the field to congratulate ball players.
And Kevin Sweeney.
Quarterback.
Appear to be on the way, possibly.
Now, tonight's Canon camera play of the game is chosen by ESPN's production staff. Brought to you by Canon cameras, so advanced they're the world's leader in 35 millimeter photography. This is our play of the game. It came late in the ball game. Beautiful move by Kelly Skipper. He cut it back. He goes 42 yards for the touchdown.